fifth meeting in 2016 of the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. The only item on our agenda today is stage one consideration of the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Amendment Bill, on which you'll hear from three separate sets of witnesses this morning. First of all, can I please remind everyone present to turn off any mobile phones, tablets or other electronic devices. Before we start, I'd like to invite Leslie Brennan, MSP, to declare any relevant interests.
I have no relevant interest to declare.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Turning now to the bill, our first panel of witnesses consists of John Blackwood of the Scottish Association of Landlords, Paul Curran of the Scottish Property Federation, Daryl McIntosh of the National Association of Estate Agents, and Marian Reid of the Chartered Institute of Housing Scotland. I intend to allow 75 minutes or so for this session. I'd like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting. Members of the committee have received submissions from each of our witnesses, so we'll go straight to questions from the committee. Now, obviously, we're very tight for time this morning. We've only got about 4 hours in total for our three panels. We'll get the budget this afternoon. So what I'll do is I'll be asking questions of individual members of the panel. Other members of the panel can comment if they wish, but I'm not going around necessarily all four members with the one question, otherwise we'll be here all day and colleagues won't have an opportunity to come in, and I'm sure many of them have questions. So I'll set the scene, if you like, with some questions, and members will then come in subsequently. So, first of all, who will the first question be to? I would think probably I would like to ask Mr. Blackwood, in your submission, paragraph 2, you talk about the issue of the 3% rate for the supplement and the impact that might have on inward investment. You said that the tax rate should be lowered in the purchase. This will help attract investment to Scotland despite the less favourable legal framework. For this reason, we believe the tax rate should be lowered and the purchase price threshold raised. How much investment in buy-to-let comes from outside Scotland as a percentage of the market?
I suppose that's one thing, Convener, we're not aware of. We're certainly aware that actually we need to encourage investment here in Scotland, and that's exactly what we would like to be doing. So we do have a different, as you're aware, a different framework of regulation on the private rented sector, and that's just about to change even more with the recent Housing Tenancies Bill. So we feel that perhaps investors will view Scotland in a different light in the future. So in order to meet the Scottish Government's aims of increasing investment and growth in the PRS, we want to attract investment. And if that's out with Scotland, do we want to do that?
Okay, well, the Scottish Property Federation has said in paragraph 7 of their report that currently less than 2% of built-to-rent PRS investment is being directed to Scotland, so it's not really having much impact at the moment, the current situation. So if we have we have a level playing field with the UK, we're going to have a level playing field with the UK after this. So how is this legislation going to make life any more difficult in Scotland than would otherwise be the case?
Well, I think we won't have a level playing field because of the framework of regulation that we will have here in Scotland. So investors will view that differently. And my colleagues representing institutional investors can tell you more about that than me as to their attitudes about investing here long term in Scotland as opposed to what is the case at the moment. So we're concerned about the future. We know we need to increase investment, however we do that, and Scotland needs to become a more attractive place to invest in the future.
Okay, and basically you're also saying that that this will have a consequence for the house building industry itself, as buy-to-let purchases at a significant proportion of off-plan sales. Other witnesses have said the opposite, in actual fact, that it will free up more private houses available for other people to buy.
Well, I think our main concern is the lack of appropriate data sets for us to really look at the situation and see what is the concern here in Scotland. And obviously all we're going from is the feedback we're getting from our members and the concerns raised by them. So we certainly know that we want to increase investment, we want to increase investment in new build properties as well too. So how can we actually do that? So, but we don't have available information to really see how much of an issue really is this in Scotland. And the Finance Secretary is very keen to make sure that first-time buyers have an incentive, if not certainly an advantage against private landlords. We don't believe that there is that concern or that issue here in Scotland. But again, there's a lack of appropriate data sets to quantify that.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, Mr. Curran, you've said in paragraph 12 of your own submission that the supplement will be imposed as a slab tax, exactly the same approach that the Scottish Government was keen to move away from when it took responsibility for a stamp duty land tax in Scotland. Can you tell me, expand a wee bit on what concerns you might have about that?
I think what we're sort of inferring there is that the issues around having more of a progressive taxation system, so that we, with the changes to LBTT, we sort of we took away that sort of threshold point, the £250,000 sort of threshold point, and everything was priced around 249,995. So it's just sort of trying to get away from that approach and avoiding the sort of slab tax approach to this particular policy. I think the issue is really a case of should there be something that really from a sort of institutional investment aspect that there should really be more exemption in terms of what's got to go in there, because at the moment the way it's drafted we don't have any exemptions or any sort of trigger points really for the tax to come into force.
I mean, you say there's no exemptions in actual fact, but esteemed advisor to the committee, Professor McEwen, has actually written a really excellent paper on behalf of the committee, which looks at the potential to ride a coach and horses actually through this legislation instead of some of potential ways in which people can avoid actually paying it, particularly companies. You know, so I mean, surely if you add a lot of exemptions, the legislation will effectively become virtually worthless, will it not?
I mean, I think what we're trying to look at is we're looking at how do we keep Scotland competitive? How do we attract the global capital that we've talked about in terms of investment? The majority of, a large majority of private development finance now comes from either overseas or large UK institutions. So that waterfall effect of funding into Scotland, particularly on things like large-scale PRS, is going to be impacted if we have an exemption or don't have an exemption in some of these sort of larger scale sort of developments. So with the scale of development that could be planned and in terms of the unit numbers there, I think it really is something that we've got to get in there, and it's got to be competitive in terms of the scale of development that's possible down south compared to the scale of development that's possible in Scotland. So it's looking at it from the institutional side, but then also from a development perspective, SME type housing provision, where you are really looking at smaller scale developers who again are looking at an element of funding required. That funding is dependent on getting an element of pre-sales, and if again, sort of looking at smaller scale developments, if that pre-sale isn't achievable through some form of buy-to-let opportunity, then the development just might not start.
Well, I mean, it looks to me, actually, Mr. McIntosh, from your submission, that you don't think that would necessarily be a bad thing, because in paragraph 5 you've said fewer people entering the buy-to-let market is encouraging for first-time buyers because they won't be in competition with as many individuals looking to invest in buy-to-let properties or second homes. So are you saying basically that without the kind of competition from these big investors, theoretically big investors that we're talking about, it would keep house prices at a more reasonable level for first-time buyers, for example?
I think theoretically it's, if deterring investors with the additional tax, then theoretically the first-time buyer market should improve. But however, I think the main stumbling block will always be the lack of finance available to the first-time buyers, which is what we're finding. And again, we don't have any evidence, and we're not hearing it from our members, that first-time buyers are actually losing out to investors. They're not being priced out of properties. They're just unavailable to purchase them at the moment through the lack of finance that's available to them.
Okay, fair enough. And now, in terms of your submission, you also say you express a concern that for those people who decide to invest in second homes on particular buy-to-let property after April, it's likely that this may see rent rises as landlords attempt to recoup the cost of paying the additional home supplement. Is that a real concern for you?
I think it will be, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think if people having to, investors are having to pay additional tax, then it's basically from their budget that they're not going to be able to do for any improvements for any rental properties. And I think that is going to be a big concern, or increase the rents.
Now, just before I go on to the Chartered Institute of Housing, I'm just wondering if members of the panel have a view on what the kind of general margins are in terms of landlords in Scotland. I know we've got about 150,000, and the average landlord is only about 2.5 properties, so some only have one, two, some have many. But what are the kind of margins that landlords in the buy-to-let sector are working to at the moment? Does anyone have any kind of information on that?
The thing I can add, Convener, is that obviously it depends on the kind of marketplace that you're investing in. So we have some small-scale landlords with one or two properties that might be investing in property in the region of 200,000 or thereof for houses multiple occupation. So potentially, perhaps the yield there is higher for some than it would be with somebody with a small one-bedroom flat in the centre of Edinburgh, for instance. So therefore their yield could be much smaller. So it depends what your motivation is as an investor. Many people are investing, like myself, looking longer term, not looking at short term gain. So you're looking at capital appreciation and potentially you're seeing it as part of a pension pot effectively. So I think it's very difficult to assess average yields because of the variety of the marketplace that we actually have there and different motivations of individual landlords too.
Okay. Now, Ms. Reid, you basically said in section 2.3 of your submission that it's our understanding the policy will not directly impact on the build-to-let market because you've said that remains small. I wonder if you can expand a wee bit on that.
I think that's not the main thrust of our submissions, so no, I've probably got less details on the build-to-let market.
No, it's just because we've touched on that, obviously.
Than our other colleagues, and that's not the area that we're primarily concerned about, in particularly in relation to our members as well.
Okay, right, fair enough. I'll ask you something else then. I mean, what you have said in 1.3 in general comments is that we agree with the general principles behind the policy, however, it would be more important to ensure that it does not have any unintended consequences or a negative impact on the overall housing market. So I wonder if you can comment on that. What unintended consequences concern you?
I think there are a range, potentially, and they relate partly to the private rent sector, which clearly other colleagues have been highlighting, but also to the housing association sector and local authorities. Both housing associations and local authorities buy properties out of the owner-occupied market for a number of reasons. It may be in the case of local authorities where homeowners are struggling with mortgage payments and there's a scheme whereby local authorities can buy those properties and the homeowners rent. There's mid-market renting through the National Housing Trust. Mid-market rent is a very important part of the market at the moment. What it does is it provides affordable housing for people who potentially they can't afford to buy, but they may not fall within the remit or be housed through the social rented sector because of pressures in that sector. We recently did a survey, a member survey, in relation to evidence we put together for the Fairer Scotland submission we'd put in. And in that, ourselves, local authorities are very keen to increase their capacity to build, but they have restrictions such as land supply, the cost of land. There are sometimes planning issues in terms of the length of time it takes to get things through. And they were identifying that being able to buy properties on the open market is actually filling a niche in terms of being able to provide housing, affordable housing.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'm going to open out the session to colleagues around the table. So the first person to ask questions will be Gavin, to be followed by John.
Thank you. Good morning. Okay, first question. I understand a stakeholders reference group has been set up by the Scottish Government. Very quickly, are any of you on that group? Paul, Mr. Curran?
Yeah, I think SPF or...
SPF, right. Yeah. Okay, but the other three organisations are not on it. Okay. Second question, the policy objective, you'll have seen the policy memorandum. Policy objective is to ensure that the opportunities for first-time buyers to enter the housing market in Scotland remain as strong as they possibly can. Now, obviously, the benefit to first-time buyers here is that it's less attractive for buy-to-let properties. But the disadvantage for first-time buyers, from some of your submissions anyway, is that there could be a reduced amount of new house building and activity on the market. Taking those two factors into account, the pros and the cons for first-time buyers, does this legislation ultimately make life better for first-time buyers? Is it neutral, or does it potentially make life trickier for first-time buyers? I'm happy for anyone to answer that question first.
Start off with that. I suppose at the very best, I think it would be neutral. And obviously at the worst, it'd be detrimental to them. I think perversely, what could happen potentially is you've got landlords who could, at the moment, be, for instance, as I mentioned earlier about investing round about the 160 to the 200,000 mark, and they, because of the increase in taxation, overall, their pot of money is still the same amount of money. So they would then need to think, well, I'm going to have to invest in something that's perhaps smaller, a smaller unit, and that would take them into the same bracket as perhaps the first-time buyers in the 145 bracket. So therefore, we're concerned that actually it might push some investors who are not potentially competing against first-time buyers at the moment into actually competing with them. Although, to be honest, we don't see the research or the evidence to say that they're competing with them in the first place.
Okay, I wonder if other panel members have views on that initial question.
I think, one of the main things in terms of first-time buyer market is all about affordability, and that's the key issue, and affordability is obviously impacted by supply of housing. If we're going through something that would make it more difficult for developers to obtain development funding, especially on the sort of SME aspect or type of company, it's going to reduce potentially the availability of houses for people to buy at the lower level.
Okay. Any other thoughts on that one?
Housing markets are not a national thing. They're also very local. So the consequences of this will depend on the locality. And also there's the rural-urban difference as well. So there just might be scarcity of property anyway in rural areas. And in some instances, potentially, if the consequence of this is squeezing out some of the private sector landlords, that may be a negative impact. And it may be that even within those localities, because of the economy, that first-time buyers are struggling anyway. And that's why we're recommending that it's definitely important to have a review period and actually monitor how this would work on the ground if it's implemented.
Okay. Thank you. Next question. One of the issues put before us is that there's likely to be what's called forestalling, i.e. lots of activity could take place before the 1st of April in order to avoid this 3% tax. In terms of what your organisations have seen on the ground since the announcement in the middle of December, have we seen any evidence on the ground? I mean, we won't have figures, I'm sure, but have we seen any evidence on the ground of forestalling taking place, or is it too difficult or early to say at this stage?
I think from our feedback that they have noticed that there is a spike already.
There is a
spike. To try and get in from April, and they noticed that with the introduction of LBTT as well, that there was a spike.
Okay, fine. All right, next question is the second policy objective, which I have to say I do find plausible. It's necessary to ameliorate the likely distortions which will arise in Scotland when the new SDLT higher rates are introduced. So obviously this is happening south of the border as of 1st of April as well, and that's one of the reasons given for bringing the policy in. On the face of it, it seems like a plausible policy objective. Is it? Are we likely to see an influx of buy-to-let investors from south of the border if we don't do this by 1st of April?
I think it's quite hard to say or quite hard to measure that. But we do have a different regime in terms of the private rented sector, and there's a lot of work that's been done to support the sector and to raise standards. But that includes additional regulation and new tenancy regime. And so potentially that might deter investors, because dealing with different countries and different regimes is not in itself always entirely straightforward at the best of times, and we're moving in a very particular way in Scotland, but it's hard to quantify.
Hard to say.
I'm afraid.
Okay. I'll just come to some individual papers now. If I may, we'll start with the Scottish Association of Landlords. So, Mr. Blackwood, that'll be you. I mean, you've set out your position. You've given a range, I guess, of potential exemptions or reliefs that your organisation would call for, should the legislation proceed. I can read them out. Exemptions for 6-plus properties, similar to multiple dwellings relief, exemptions for new build, exemptions for joint purchase, exemptions for houses that are not suitable for mortgages, exemptions for properties on the market for greater than 6 months, and exemption for existing buy-to-let holiday homes. Obviously, a fair number of exemptions in that. I mean, can you just briefly, and I don't give us chapter and verse, but just what are the consequences of not having exemptions for some of the measures you've called for?
Discourage investment, and that's our biggest concern. We want to encourage that. In fact, we want more people to be investing in the private rented sector, and that's institutional investors as well as individual investors. So we took approach with this paper and a submission is if it's going to happen, and we all know it's happening in other parts of the UK, what could be the consequence of that, and equally what can we do to mitigate that? And we've looked at specific areas here to think that actually maybe there is an argument for exemptions, and that would help alleviate the potential negative impact of the proposal.
Okay. For my own benefit, the expression not suit a property that is not suitable for mortgage, what does that mean?
Some properties of non-standard construction, and it's a case of they're perfectly habitable, there's nothing wrong with the properties, but for mortgage purposes, perhaps because of when they were built or the kind of construction, like timber framed, for instance, that's a concern for some mortgage lenders. So therefore, they are not in the mainstream, as it were, there. So perhaps we need to encourage them to remain in the marketplace and to be turned over if the seller wants to actually obviously get rid of them. So we want to encourage that, and maybe that's something that we could be looking at there too.
Okay.
But first-time buyers aren't competing in that marketplace.
Sure, okay. Now, the idea of discouraging investment, I guess, could apply to a few of the exemptions or reliefs you've called for. Exempt properties that have been on the market for a longer period than 6 months, what's the sort of explanation for that relief or exemption?
Again, behind that was that there seems to be an assumption there's competition here. So we've got first-time buyers vying against private landlords here for the same properties. We don't see the evidence of that, but I think the evidence would be such that if it's been lying there for months and nobody's buying it, then obviously landlords are not interested in that. So rather than having a property potentially lying empty and not turning over in the marketplace, is it not better to actually shift that? And if that's shifting it into the PRS, then it's providing more housing for people to live in. So we saw that as a positive step.
Okay, thank you. Scottish Property Federation paper, when you talk about some similar exemptions, the main exemption that you seem to be calling for, though, is an exemption where the transaction involves more than six properties. Can you just expand on that, please?
I mean, there's two aspects to it. One is sort of large-scale PRS investment. So what we want to avoid is the position where there's no exemption on sort of that type of investment. That's one of the main opportunities, I think, to deliver a lot of the housing requirement that's out there at the moment. I think if we don't have that exemption or a level of exemption, then it would be... it would sort of put us in a less competitive position, certainly against the UK, in terms of trying to attract that institutional or overseas investment into these large-scale projects where there is definitely a huge appetite to invest in. But the more costly it becomes to do that, the less attractive it is for these investors to sort of tick the box in terms of their investment committees. I think the other section on that is really smaller properties, SMEs again. I mean, a large proportion of property market was decimated, which we need to remember. Back in 2008, 2009, a lot of SME house builders were no longer exist because of the crash in the property market. So we really want to encourage that sort of entrepreneurial type of organisation to support and deliver a large proportion of new build property that's required to meet demand. So I think by bringing in an exemption at a level of six properties on an individual new build development, then that gives an opportunity to be slightly more competitive than maybe the rest of the UK. But certainly in terms of scale of development in Scotland, it's something that will allow something to be funded, because
these smaller SME type organisations are heavily dependent on funding. That funding on those types of sites is very much dependent on achieving a level of pre-sales, and pre-sales tend to be more buy-to-let type landlords.
Okay. And just finally then, to you again, Mr Curran, you obviously have a sister organisation in the British Property Federation who are presumably involved in the SDLT change consultation. From your discussions with them, I mean, are there things we can be learning from that consultation and that process that might speed things up and help us to avoid making mistakes up here?
Yeah, I mean, I think from my knowledge of their discussions with the UK government, I mean, the exemption levels they're looking at are higher. They're looking at 15 units as an exemption level, and I think that's been taken again sort of as something that's key in retaining that attractiveness of institutional and other types of investment. The reason we would be looking for something lower is just recognising the scale of the Scottish market in comparison to the rest of the UK and the scale of the smaller investor, the smaller developments. So we don't have London-scale developments all over Scotland. We tend to depend heavily on smaller schemes of 20, 30 units. So having six units on some of these developments is a reasonable level.
Grateful. Thank you. Convener, thank you.
Thank you. We've now been joined by Jackie Bailey, and the next question to be asked will be by John, to be followed by Leslie.
Hey, thanks, Convener. I mean, I think London was just mentioned in the last answer, so I was thinking about London. I mean, if somebody's sitting in London with £500,000 spare, and they're thinking of buying a house for £200,000 in Scotland, a second home, then whether it costs £206,000, £220,000, I mean, is that really going to affect them? Because they're not going to go to Birmingham and save a few thousand and pay 190, are they? So I suppose my ultimate question is, do we need to worry what's happening down south? Have we not got a separate market up here?
I don't think we've got a separate market. I mean, it's very much a competing UK market. When you're looking at investment, whether it's small scale, large scale, people are looking at what that individual city competes as. I mean, it's whether you look at the larger scale property market, where we are very much competing against Manchester, Birmingham, London, all the regional cities. But as an individual investor with £500,000, £200,000, whatever they have to spend, they're going to be looking at the yields that they can achieve on that. So the minute we start adding an additional level of taxation on that, then it becomes less attractive.
If they're in home for themselves, then the yield's not an issue, really, is it? Would location not be more of the issue rather than...
Yeah, but I mean, if you're looking at location, then it's very much a personal purchase, isn't it?
Yes.
So it's not an investment decision.
Yes. But this bill, as I understand it, is looking at personal purchases as well as investments.
It is, but I think, I mean, in terms of the buy-to-let market, and this is what it would probably impact most on, the relevance is more to what the investor view would be on it. I think personal purchase decisions, I mean, I can answer for individuals in terms of doing that.
But, I mean, a lot of villages in Scotland are being gobbled up by people making personal decisions, aren't they?
I think, yeah, I mean, I think there are, yeah. There's potentially, yeah.
Yes. Okay. And then I suppose following on from that, I mean, you've argued that I don't know what others feel, but that the market is all one for the UK and it's not a separate one in Scotland. I suppose I still feel that some people actually want to live in Scotland and the price isn't the only factor. But I mean, if say we waited for a year and saw what happened and then legislated if there was a problem, I mean, is that something you think would be a good idea or a bad idea? I don't mind who answers.
If I may answer that point and just come in there, I think that would be a more sensible approach. I think we need to actually do more research into this, actually understand the dynamics of this issue in Scotland. Is there a need for a surcharge? And if so, specifically where? I take your point actually completely about second homes. I think that's a completely different marketplace. And, you know, as a parliament, as a government, that should be taken into consideration. For people who are investing, like the people we are representing, they're investing in providing homes for people, which are primary homes for people. And I think that should be seen differently and not tagged the same as somebody who just wants to have a nice little bolt hole in Scotland somewhere.
They are still competing, aren't they, with first-time buyers? Because if the big company if the person cannot afford to buy a house, then they're forced into the private rented sector. I mean, I know there's a whole issue that some people want to be in the private rented sector, but some people want to buy and their second choice is the private rented sector. So if we unfairly advantage the big company by giving them exemptions, does that not even further disadvantage the first-time buyer?
I think we would need to look at the motivation of that investment. And I know that's difficult to analyse and to regulate for, but at the end of the day, if you're investing for the purpose of renting out that property, whether it's as an institutional investor or as a private landlord, I think you should be encouraged to do that. We need more of that. The Scottish Government has set very clearly in its objectives to grow and develop the PRS. So that's what we want to see happening. In my view,
but
that's
presumably
not
at the
and
expense.
Developing second yes. home ownership. Uh-huh.
But I mean, presumably we don't want to help the private rented sector at the expense of the bought sector. I mean, yes, we want to help both in a sense. We want more investment, yes. Yeah. But I mean, these ideas, maybe this is a good time, you know, giving exemption to somebody who's got 6 properties or 15 properties. I mean, that it's like giving a, you know, cheaper rates for the supermarket compared to the corner shop. It disadvantages the corner shop. Would that not disadvantage the first time buyer?
I think I don't know is the answer to that question, and I think we need more research to really understand that issue, and I think that's our concern. We're not understanding exactly what's happening here in Scotland. There's been research done in England and in the southeast of England in particular, but we don't see that correlating here in Scotland. We could be wrong, it's just that we don't have the data sets to properly understand the issue. The average house price that first-time buyers are actually going for and it's costing them is £133,000. That's round about that price range. So we don't see that as a major issue in the sense of that first-time buyers are actually being pushed out the marketplace because of people with second homes, or indeed my main concern is private landlords and people in the PRS.
Okay, I mean, would any of the other, on that particular point about, you know, surely it's unfair to give more exemptions to a company with 6 and 15 houses than the individual person who's trying to get onto the property ladder. Would any of you of the three have thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of disadvantaging, I don't think it does disadvantage because, again, you're looking at housing supply and it's, again, back to affordability, and the more houses that are built, then lower prices should be. So the more that can be done to encourage an increase in supply and affordability, whether it be PRS or homes for sale, then it's got to be beneficial to everyone.
I mean, it's getting a bit wider, but I mean, I'm sitting in a constituency with loads of empty land and nobody wants to build on it. So, you know, I do feel that the builders are guilty of not doing what you're suggesting, that you know, there would be more, there is demand and they could build more. But perhaps that's another question. I mean, if I could touch on students, which I don't think we've touched on that so far, the whole question of purpose-built student accommodation, I don't know if any of you are actually kind of got expertise in that, but there has been a suggestion that they should be treated separately. I just wondered if anyone supported that or opposed that.
I think it's, again, it's a slightly different asset class and it's not a property that's on the open market for letting. So I think, I mean, we've covered that in part of our submission that we would support that being sort of exempt from it as well.
Yeah, I mean, I had the case where property was built in my constituency for students, but then it was sold off to individuals who weren't students by mistake. So I just wonder how strong these categories are, that because we say something is purpose-built for students, it's you know, they should be treated separately. Presumably, at some stage, they could be sold off separately.
I mean, it's more of a question for planning and the classification around what the buildings have been constructed for and what consent they have.
Now, in fact, Leslie and myself are both on the DPLR committee, which generally doesn't look at the policy, but one point that came up for us was the question of valuation of properties, and I just wonder if that's a concern for anyone. I didn't particularly pick it up, although I read the papers, I confess, fairly quickly. Will it be clear how properties are valued, do you feel, from the legislation, or is that a concern? And I suppose related to that, you know, will there have to be frequent valuations if somebody has got a property that's near a boundary of value, like 40,000? If nobody's got a comment or it's an answer, that's fine. I've got lots of other things I can ask as well. I mean, another one, again, I don't know if any of you have experience of this, but this, the whole question of that you could pay up front and then reclaim later on if you've sold your property, and because some people in Scotland are buying first before they actually sell. I mean, they might be trying to sell first, but they don't manage to for various reasons. And there's other reasons as well why you might pay up front the tax and then have to reclaim it. Is that something, there have been concerns raised about that. Is that something that any of you have concerns about, or is that not an issue?
I think that was a concern that had been raised, more for people accidentally falling into it or through no fault of their own. As you hit on somebody that has already purchased and then their sale falling through through their purchaser, they've then got to complete their purchase and they then have two homes which they have never had any intentions of having anyway, so they are unfairly penalised. They probably don't have the finance, or they're scraping together the finance to pay any bridging loan, and then they have this extra tax that they're going to unfairly or unjustly have to pay as well and then claim back.
Is there a way, do you think, of doing that then?
I don't know what we would do.
Because, I mean, the fear from my point of view would be that if you just said, if people could say, well, my intention is to sell my house, you know, and then lots of people say that, well, you know, the whole system starts falling apart, because then you have to start chasing people a year later and seeing, well, did you sell it? Did you not sell it? I mean, it's tidier to do it this way, but I kind of feel, as you've said, that there is a, for some people, that would be quite an issue.
Yeah, I don't know the best way.
Okay. I mean, another specific example was if a family was to buy for their children, they would be charged.
Yes.
Is that really a problem?
I would think so, yes. We see that a lot, certainly in the university cities, that people are purchasing for or with children on the mortgage as well, or to get them on the ladder. So they're in effect helping them be first-time buyers as well. So that's going to be an issue as well.
Could they not just lend them the money? Or do they not trust their children? Oh, no, don't chance that one. I think my final point would actually be on housing associations. Now, I realise none of you are housing associations, but we don't actually have any housing associations coming before us today, so I don't know if any of you are comfortable in that area, but should they be treated any differently, or is there an issue there that they should be just treated like everybody else?
Concern around housing associations is around the mid-market rent area, where housing associations have subsidiaries and they deal in a slightly different way, or under a slightly different regime. But if they were subject to this would affect their operation in terms of what they were able to do and their flexibility, and they're meeting a housing need and sometimes in quite pressurised areas for, as I was saying earlier, people that can't afford to buy, but they're not going to fall into the criteria where they're eligible for social housing because there's such a squeeze on the waiting list. So, yeah, there are definitely implications.
So they're more kind of competing with the normal private rented sector, but they're slightly cheaper, as I understand it.
Yeah, they're mid-market rents. Yes. So I don't know what the rate, I'm not an expert on the rates of where they sit, but yeah, it's kind of mid-market, as
I mean,
it
80%
says,
has been mentioned,
yes,
but I think
yes,
it varies, yes.
So that's our concern.
So would they be treated in the same way as the normal private rented sector, or do you think they should be treated more favourably, perhaps, because of this kind of social aspect?
I think they're meeting a slightly different market, potentially. They're meeting a market that potentially can't go out there in the marketplace and go, right, I want private lets, and, you know, I've got a whole range of choice because I have that income. They're filling a niche, and that's why they're there, and that's why local authorities have involvement in that as well. So, I mean, it's quite a complicated housing system at the moment. There's quite a lot of things going on, and just trying to balance all the different bits and not have these unintended consequences on parts of the market that are meeting need that might not be met elsewhere is quite important to get that balance right.
I mean, I think actually you've raised an important point there, this whole point about things being complicated and complex, and my hope had been, and I think we did achieve it with LBTT, that it was a fairly straightforward tax. Is this really going to complicate things, having this?
I think it's more about the points that we're raising are about the potential consequences and just trying to think through what those are. And I think we're all probably struggling a bit as well because we don't all have the data to let us know that yet. So, yeah, it's hard to say.
Yes. I mean, I wonder, Mr. McIntosh, for you, I mean, for an estate agent, are they going to have to ask a lot more questions to is that solicitor that does that for the person?
It's going to be the solicitor's job to...
Right.
To
so it shouldn't complicate your
it's certainly
members.
For an agent side of thing, then no, it shouldn't. They're still going to market the property at the relevant valuation.
Okay. Thanks so much.
Okay, thank you. Eliza to be followed by Mark.
Hey, thanks, Convener. I did do a study for Scottish Government in 2009 on the baseline of the private rented sector in Scotland. I didn't know whether, anyway. But actually, one of the things that did come up there was actually the lack of data. Thus, it's really quite disappointing if we published that report for Scottish Government in 2009, what we're here now, and actually the data is not particularly improved. Because actually what I've heard, is quite a lot of anecdotal evidence, but actually there's not much robustness there. Because can I ask, and actually I have done a number of private rented sector studies down in England as well, and actually even focus groups with landlords, and what I missed was actually what you're describing is, it seems to be the philanthropic landlords, because you're suggesting that actually the landlords are investing to give people housing, whereas actually the landlords I spoke to across the country were investing because it was a good rental yield.
I want them to be investing to provide more housing. That's the whole point, and that's the whole thrust. We need more housing in Scotland, so therefore we should encourage investment. But yes, they're doing it as business people. You know, they're doing it maybe not for a short-term gain, so the yield might be negligible, to be perfectly honest, in some scenarios, but they're looking at long-term gain. Yeah, of course they are. They're business people looking to do that. But what we're trying to encourage them to do is saying Scotland's a place to do business. Investing in property is something that should be attractive and you could actually do, albeit there's regulation you need to follow. You're providing a service and that needs to be a good service. But actually, this is a business actually that's worth doing. And what's the consequence of this long term? We provide housing for people. And I think that's something that we should be encouraging here in Scotland.
Actually, can I ask you a further question, Mr. Blackwood? In your submission, you suggested that the biggest impact of the proposals will be on vulnerable tenants, as less money will be spent on improving stock.
Well, potentially, if there's less money to go around, there's less money to actually go in and improving those properties that people are investing in. So if they've gone and purchased a property, at the end of the day, they've got a finite pot of money to actually invest, which includes capital costs, taxation, all other forms of regulation. And that continues. That's not just at the point of purchase. So you could actually, inadvertently, as a result of all of this, and it's not just one thing having this effect, it's all regulation together, meaning that a landlord has less money, longer term, to invest in their properties, and we don't want that either. We want them to be putting the money back into their properties.
Can I ask, there's a comment from Shelter about large... landlords actually crowding out first-time buyers just because obviously they'll be able to access cheaper credit. What's your view on that?
I can't really talk about larger investors, to be honest, really more institutional investors. It's not my field, whether they can access better ranges of funding. I can't comment on, to be honest, really. From an individual investor's perspective, which is my area, then, to be honest, it's not more attractive for them to access funding than it is a first-time buyer. So,
okay. Is anybody else going to comment on that? About? No. Can I ask CIH, sorry, Ms. Reid, you had said in your submission on 1.4, in addition, we feel that if the measure is to support the housing market in a meaningful way, the additional funds raised should be reinvested in the housing sector.
Yes, and we meant by that the affordable housing sector, so that we actually keep supporting and maintaining the aspirations that we all currently have to increase affordable housing supply. Now, that doesn't mean always to reinvest it in local authorities or housing associations. It can be also going towards carrying on to improve the standards in the private rented sector, because Primarily, there are a great deal of smaller landlords in Scotland, and I can't remember if we talked about it in our submission, but you know, you see this term accidental landlords. People inherit property, they rent it out, or two people move together and they don't sell a second property. And yes, those people are doing it as an investment, but it's also important they get the help and support they need to be the best landlords they can be. So yeah, we do feel very strongly that it is important that the money is reinvested, especially if there are potential for adverse effects on parts of the market that's providing social housing.
And just lastly, could I just ask this? Obviously, I think John had pointed to it about the 4.1 of your submission, just about local authorities and registered social landlords should not be subject to the charge if purchasing homes on the open market. So is that, because you'd mentioned about mid-market rents, but actually I'm aware, I'm a councillor in Dundee, and actually Dundee City Council bought housing in the open market, which is actually, they're renting out as sort of, yeah, affordable, well, social rent.
Yeah, and there's different reasons that happens. So in, I don't know the specific example or why that's happened, but it may be even, for example, sometimes there are blocks where the local authorities, a landlord, may have some of those properties, but others have been sold through right to buy. And if they come up on the market and the price is obviously appropriate, they may choose to bring them back into local authority stock because, again, as I was saying earlier on, it's an easier... If it all stacks up financially, it's an easier thing to do than start from scratch and build something else. And also, it can create a more coherent community, and it makes more sense in terms of maintenance. That's just one example of that. But there are several reasons why local authorities might do that for different rationales. Maybe.
So you'd be looking for an exemption for registered social landlords?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. That's my question.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, Convener. Just a couple of questions. The notion has been raised that this would potentially hamper new build development because a lot of new build development is predicated on advanced sale, and that would be in the buy-to-let market. Does anybody have any detail on the percentage of new build properties that are purchased as buy-to-let? Focusing a lot of blank expressions. And the reason that's a concern for me is that there appears to be a sort of a certainty being inferred from supposition in that, is that if we don't know what percentage of new build properties are being sold as buy to let, it's very difficult to then infer what the impact on new build properties would be as a result of this surcharge, were it to have a behavioural impact. Would that be a fair assessment? I'll maybe start with Mr. Curran.
I mean, the point you've raised is, I mean, one of timing and information and research that's required to properly consider this. And I think that is one of the issues in terms of the pace maybe that we're going at in reviewing this, that more research and more information is required, more analysis of the market is required.
And maybe from you, Ms. Reid, I mean, obviously from house builders' perspectives, are any of them saying to you that it is that the them accessing the capital to develop is based upon the or is predicated upon the buy-to-let market being part of their advanced sales?
Closely with house builders, okay. It's more on the social rent sector.
Right.
I'm sorry,
okay.
I just don't have that
okay. But from SPF?
SPF, I mean, it's definitely something, again, sort of referring back to the sort of SME-type organisation, the sort of more entrepreneurial organisations who deliver the smaller scale developments. It very much is something that is key, whether it's securing equity funding or bank funding, that banks still need a level of certainty in terms of how they're going to get their money back, and that is delivered by achieving a small number of pre-sales on sites.
And
again, there's no evidence.
Well, I was about to say, and presumably there is no evidence that those pre-sales could not be undertaken by people, for example, upscaling into a new property, or indeed first-time buyers entering the market.
There's no evidence to support either way, but I think the key thing really there is, I mean, in terms of people trying to secure first-time buyer property, I mean, a developer will sell to either. I mean, they will sell. There's not a specific preference, but I think it's in terms of early sales within a development to enable development, whereby first-time buyers just won't be able to have certainty on funding, so they won't be able to commit to a contractual position.
in terms of committing to development within a development now, before you can actually, if that makes sense, before you can actually start construction.
Okay, so in terms of the, I'm trying to think the best way to word this one. So from the perspective of those developers, what kind of level are they talking? What kind of percentage of advanced sale do most developments have to achieve in order to be able to access that capital?
I mean, if you were looking at small-scale development, again, you'd be looking at maybe 20%. So that's, if you're looking at small-scale development, it'd be 30 units. And I think that's where roughly the level of 6 units come from on the exemptions for new build properties. So that would give you an indication. Some lenders may look for a higher proportion of forward purchase, depending on the type of property. If it's an apartment scheme, they may look for a higher percentage. It could be 40%, 30%. But generally, yeah, if you're achieving something in the region of 20-25%, it's enough to enable the development to commence.
Okay. Mr. Blackwood, you had mentioned the difficulty in attracting inward investment, and I think the figure had been raised that at the moment around 2% was the figure in terms of capital Firth of Scotland that is invested in terms of the buy-to-let. So I guess my question would be is if that is the current situation at present, would maintaining the status quo really have that much of an impact in terms of attraction? If they haven't already been attracted beyond a level of 2%, is it really likely that that's going to shift quite dramatically were this surcharge not to be introduced?
The point we would like to make is we want to see an increase in that investment both within Scotland and out with Scotland as well too. So 2% is low, we want that to be higher. Why do we want that? Because there's not enough housing for people. So we need to encourage that. And that's across the board, across the whole PRS for different areas within the PRS as well too.
But surely the flip of that is that if you have that increase in investment, the properties that increase in investment is going to purchase are going to be those properties that could potentially be purchased by first-time buyers, are they not?
It could happen, and again, we don't know exactly. We're only working potentially proxy data sets to look at that. At the moment, though, we don't have evidence of that, so we don't have the surcharge at the moment. I know it's early days because it's only been recently introduced in other parts of the UK, but nevertheless, are first-time buyers being pushed out the market? Do we have evidence that actually house prices are going up? No, we don't actually. So that's not the case of recent times here in Scotland. So I think that would be an indication that actually, if prices go up, then that means that's an issue. Why is that an issue? Well, is it maybe there is competition or more competition in the marketplace? Don't believe that is the case at the moment. That's not to say that wouldn't happen in the future. I appreciate that. But we seem to be guessing what's going to happen and making or implementing a surcharge based on, again, supposition.
In terms of the call for an exemption that's been raised, and I think it was SPF who called for this exemption to perhaps be significantly lower than that which has been introduced south of the border. I mean, what, again, presumably we have an idea of the number of entrepreneurs out there or the number of companies out there which are purchasing in bulk or purchasing a number of properties. So what percentage of the market would be impacted were there to be, say, a 15 property exemption similar to south of the border, as say against a 6, as the SPF have recommended?
I think you've got to look at it in terms of the institutional investment. I mean, that 30 billion and 2% is really sort of large-scale institutional investment in the UK, and that's where, again, the volume would come from. I think it's really sort of identifying that at the moment, without that exemption in place, we would be uncompetitive in comparison to investing in the rest of the UK. But I think when you look at the smaller new development sites, which I think is where you're sort of thinking or your questioning is sort of coming from. I mean, again, it's something that's it's hard to put a number on. Again, it's more a case of timing and analysis and being able to have time to sort of produce proper stats on that type of
thing. Sure. I guess from my perspective, the thing is that if I see somebody saying we need to have an exemption set at, say, six properties. I assume, therefore, that there is some working behind that, some hard data that will say, you know, beyond that point, there's a market distortion. But you seem to be suggesting that, well, there could be a market distortion, but we're just not very sure.
Yeah, I mean, I think what we're proposing is just really bringing it in line with what would be considered a commercial transaction. So it's keeping it in line with existing sort of legislation that's already in place.
So what, just out of curiosity, why do you think they've set it at 15 for the stamp duty land tax? If you're saying six, beyond six is where you would get into the commercial realm. Why have they set it so much higher in terms of stamp duty land tax?
I think it's just recognising the scale of the housing market in the rest of the UK in comparison to Scotland. We've got to recognise that the market here is smaller, scale of development is smaller, and that's just the reality because of the...
Presumably that's true in some locations but not others. So, for example, you could imagine 15 properties beyond being purchased in say Edinburgh, Glasgow or Aberdeen, perhaps less so in, you know, Irvine or Arran in one go, just to pick two examples from no reason whatsoever. I know. Would that be a fair?
It will be different in different locations, but no, it's how would you produce something that reflected that? It'd be very difficult.
Okay.
Thank you. That's concluded questions from the committee, but one or two further questions to ask myself in an area which hasn't really been touched on. I'll start with, Mr. Blackwood, you said, and I quote, there's not enough housing for people. But surely in a lot of areas of Scotland, there are enough houses for people. For example, Arran, which has just been mentioned, there are plenty of houses, but 42% of them are second homes. People may visit them for a couple of weeks, maybe 3-4 weeks a year, then they might rent them out for 3 or 4 months, and then for 7 or 8 months, particularly in winter, they lie empty. The impact of this, of course, is that they are often bought by people from out with the island, and this applies to many places in Scotland. Cumbria figures 50%, for example, are second homes. So the economy's weakened in winter because there's not much spend in the local shops, etc., etc. Local Indigenous islanders find it very difficult to compete for housing, etc., etc., and it's very difficult to attract teachers, NHS professionals, etc., to the island and other rural parts of Scotland because they have to pay well over the odds for housing. So surely, in at least this area, in terms of second homes, this charge 3% will have a positive impact, and it will allow at least some respite for people who want to buy their own home as opposed to having to compete with second homeowners.
I agree with what you've said. Our organisations, they are representing private landlords who are in the business of buying properties to provide as principal homes for people to live in. I'm not here to advocate for people who wish to buy second homes and have them as holiday homes, as you suggest. And I think perhaps the distinction should be drawn between the two, and there isn't in legislation at the moment from council tax right the way through, and I think that's wrong. It should be the nature in which the property is used as opposed to the type of ownership.
I think the point I'm making, I was trying to make effectively, was that you're not keen on this legislation progressing, but there are positive aspects to it, and that's one area where, for example, I think there'd be a positive aspect. And Mr. McIntosh, what's the view of the National Association of Estate Agents in terms of second homes in relation to this legislation? Do you have a view on that?
It's all depending on the circumstances and how you're justifying a second home. As we've already adhered to, that the second homes that are accidental, that people have been pushed into them, or a second home that people are purchasing with or on behalf of their children as well, that is the only reason to get them onto the housing ladder. As far as for the majority of the second homes or for these instances and to get first-time buyers on, I mean, we just... I think it's constant that we're always saying that the lending criteria must improve and access to finance must be.
Okay, thanks. But back to yourself, Mr. Blackwood, in terms of another issue, which is in terms of reliefs. Under Section 4 of your submission, you've pointed out a number of areas where you would like there to be some reliefs actually applied in terms of this legislation. I'm just wondering which of these should be prioritised?
Well, we thought if we just put down a few, at least you would pick one or two of them that might be of use. So we had a bit of a brainstorming session on this one. I think, to be honest, probably in the order they're in, I think there's perhaps no accident that it's happened that way there, to be honest. There was this issue about joint purchases where one of the parties is a first-time buyer. So, like a parent, we've discussed it where a parent's buy the property, but of course it's not in their name for a number of reasons. But often it is, so they're joint owners. So again, you could say, well, it is a first-time purchase for that particular purchaser as part of that transaction. So I think that's something that perhaps could be taken into account. I think one of the biggest concerns we have is, we've touched upon it briefly, is how it's administered. You know, how can we make sure there's no loopholes through this? And actually does the job it's intended to do, which is to help first-time purchasers. And that's our concern. We really feel that, okay, we can justify so many exemptions, but is it really going to help the people that the policy is intended to do?
Okay, thanks for that. That's a good response. I appreciate that response. Gavin, you wanted to come in here?
Convener, thanks. I just wanted to come back to an issue that John Mason mentioned, which is worth exploring a bit more. It's the idea of an accidental second homeowner. So you buy a new home, your current home isn't selling, and you've got to pay this money up front. So I think Mr. Mason was correct in saying that's much cleaner and simpler. So in terms of administratively, that's clearly the best solution. But in terms of stumping the money up front, there's a challenge, I guess, to a lot of potential homeowners there. But what do you think that will have impact that will have on market activity? Because some people are naturally cautious. I mean, I have to say, it would certainly, personally, I would probably then be in a position where I would only ever sell before I ever considered buying the new home. There must be lots of people who are naturally cautious. Would that not just lead potentially to a slowdown in activity by itself? And if so, what sort of level of slowdown? Anyone? Mr. Blackwood, you were making eye contact, but it doesn't have to be you that kicks off.
No, I think, again, it's a potential unintended consequence of that. We don't want the market to slow down. You know, it's important that it's flexible and that meets market conditions when they change. I think perhaps there is a way around that, and I'm not an expert in that field, but if you're a buy-to-let investor, if you're going to invest in new property, one thing that is checked as part of money laundering processes is where's the money coming from to be able to do that? And it would be evident at the conveyance stage as to whether actually you're actually intending to sell a property and that's the intention, or whether it's on savings or you've inherited that money. So from an administrative point of view, it might not be that difficult, but there's colleagues in other fields that would be far better at answering that question than me. So, and that might alleviate some of the fears that people have about selling their own home, having to do that first before buying something else. I think that would have a negative consequence in the marketplace without a question.
Okay, there's one to explore with government, who we will see later on. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that, Gavin. I'd like to thank very much our witnesses for their answering our questions today. I realise that this has been a very truncated process, so I do appreciate the fact that you've come in at fairly short notice, and also the fairly substantial contributions that you've all made. And I'd also like to thank colleagues for their questions. I'm now going to call a recess to have a change of witnesses and allow members a natural break. We'll reconvene at 10 past 10. So I'm now going to reconvene the session. We will continue consideration of the Land Buildings and Transaction Tax Bill by taking evidence from our second panel of witnesses this morning. I therefore like to welcome to the meeting Mr. Jonathan Gordon of the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, Ms. Isobel d'Inverno of the Law Society of Scotland, Joyce of KPMG, and Susannah Simpson of PricewaterhouseCoopers. So welcome very much to the committee this morning. We obviously have your submissions, and therefore we will go straight to questions. And the first question I'll be asking will be to Mr. Gordon. Mr. Gordon, what you've said in your submission, paragraph 3, is it was prudent of the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Constitution and Economy to match the UK levy, as the Scottish housing market could have seen an influx of buy-to-let investors from England and Wales if a similar regime is not introduced. Now, you may have heard in some of the evidence from this morning, a number of our witnesses take the view that that's exactly what they did want to happen, an influx of additional investors, given the fact that only 2% of investment in buy-to-let is in Scotland, their institutional investment. So I wonder if you can expand on why you have the views that you do.
Yeah, so the RICS has a duty under its Royal Charter to look out for the interests of everybody, but the members of my PRS forum are mainly letting agents who work in the sector looking after investors and landlords, but obviously looking after the tenants as well. That's part of our process. So I have some personal views in terms of the sector, but also the RICS views to represent as a whole. The RICS view is that exactly as stated there, and there was some chat, if you follow Twitter or property groups and people, that there was some chatter around that after the Chancellor announced the change of people thinking about investing in Scotland. And I have anecdotal evidence of clients who were looking at that. So clients from England who've already invested here but have investments down south, perhaps thinking about the next one being here instead.
Okay. And your concern basically about that additional investment would be that it would push up house prices, and make it difficult for first-time buyers, would that be right?
I think personally the evidence isn't that clear on it, but there's the risk there. So the risk that you kind of have to perhaps copy the policy and then explore it further as it develops, because the risk is quite a high one. And that was the key reason stated by the Finance Secretary, I think.
So you don't think the Finance Secretary could, for example, have waited a year to see how things developed and then perhaps brought in this legislation, if necessary?
I think there's probably a range of views within the forum on that. So some people in my forum, the RICS, feel do feel that we could attract more inward investment and it wouldn't affect the market at all. Just the balance of opinion was felt within RICS policy that it was safer to copy the policy now.
Isobel, I don't think you would agree with that, because you said in terms of the general comments in the Law Society submission that the timescale and manner in which this proposal is being considered is not conducive to the formulation of good quality, robust tax legislation.
I think it goes without saying that if you have to do something in a hurry, there's a risk of making mistakes in doing it, or at least not addressing all of the issues that need to be addressed. And it is a very truncated timescale. But I think we're actually making that point with a view to the future, because I don't think this is going to be the only time that Scotland will want to introduce a measure quickly, because one's been introduced in the UK. So perhaps we need to think a little about the process that we have for doing this, because it obviously is quite an effort, or it is going to be quite an effort to get this legislation through in the timescale.
Okay. Now, one of the things that was actually said by one of our previous witnesses, Mr. Blackwood, was that it's important to ensure that such legislation has no loopholes. I was quite intrigued, actually, by your submission, because when it comes to reliefs under Section 4, you've got, like, myriad, suggestions for reliefs, such to the extent that I'm looking at the £17 to £29 million the Scottish Government hopes it will get from this, declining but as I turn them page by page. But when it comes to Section 5, the potential for tax avoidance under the supplement and how this should be addressed, you put in no comment on that, which I was quite surprised about.
I think obvious that the Scottish GAR, which we already have, will be sufficient to address any avoidance issues. Our larger concern is trying to look at some of the situations where the legislation in its current form may have quite capricious results. Circumstances might arise where it really doesn't seem fair that the supplement should have to be paid. And it's trying to deal with those that's probably our main concern and the concern of our members. I think one of these is the inadvertent ending up with two houses because something's gone wrong with your transactions and they haven't managed to both settle on the same day, which happens quite a lot. And I think that point was raised in the earlier evidence session. We think that there ought to be a grace period of, we're suggesting 30 days, where if one of your transactions doesn't complete when you thought it was going to, you don't have to pay the 3% up front, even though you have two houses, for a short period of time. And then if you haven't sold by the end of the 30 days, then you have to amend the return and pay it. And we think a 30-day period would be sufficient to deal with quite a number of cases where people have not intended to have two houses, but there's just been a hiccup somewhere along the line.
Okay, and then I'll ask you the same question I asked Mr. Blackwood. In terms of the reliefs that you've listed, what would you prioritise? I mean, you've mentioned one. Would that be your number one?
I think that one is quite important because from our members' point of view, if we don't have something like that, we're going to have to tell people you need to budget. Or some solicitors may take the view that they'll have to say to clients, you need to budget for paying this 3% because if anything goes wrong and you don't complete your purchase and sale on the same day, you're going to have to pay it. So I think that is quite an important one.
Okay, now, Joyce, you've taken the opposite view from the HAR ICS in terms of investment. What you basically said is that investors in the private rental sector are a key driver in ensuring that new residential properties are constructed, whether by way of direct investment into new developments or ensuring that house builders are confident there'll be a buoyant market for the product. I'm just wondering if you can give us some more information on that.
I think a lot of our information on this has been anecdotal from our clients. Obviously, we've been gathering information in response to both this and the introduction of the surcharge in the UK, so and a lot of our clients are nationally based. And from particularly the small and medium market, they do look to sell a lot of their properties off plan in order to forward fund that development or secure bank funding. And they often get, say, people buying one or two or three apartments in a block, which are obviously at least two of those would be for buy-to-let investments. And I think without that, they are going to struggle to get funding going forwards. Again, we haven't got hard data on this, and this is just what our clients have been telling us.
Now, Susannah Simpson, I mean, you've basically said that, in your submission that you seem concerned that unless this legislation is brought in, there'll be distortions in terms of the UK market. Now, distortions, some of the previous witnesses might say, would mean Scotland having a competitive advantage, given that only 2% of inward investment in terms of buy-to-let is directed at Scotland. So would it not actually give Scotland that competitive advantage? Or why do you have such concerns about that?
Similar to Joe's views, I suppose, in that canvassing our clients, any kind of uncertainty or inconsistency between the rest of the UK and Scotland causes additional complexity. So that's our main driver, or certainly coming out of our client base, is to keep the rules as consistent and clear and simple as possible. Taking up Isobel's point from the Law Society earlier on, I do think, however, that we shouldn't focus on that at the risk of bringing legislation through too quickly and without proper consideration. There may be benefits to be gained from delaying it and seeing how things settle south of the border.
Right, okay, that's fine. Because I mean, you've also raised some concerns in terms of the scope of charge and requirement to be disposing of the existing main residence. You talk about inconsistency in the treatment of taxpayers in similar positions, for example, where someone owns a buy-to-let property and is moving out of rented accommodation, which is their main residence, into their first home, they'll pay the extra 3%, whereas a buy-to-let investor who already owns their home and is replacing it would not.
There's a number of anomalies that will come through, and exactly as Isobel said, there's that people who are in that reluctant landlord position also should be worried about. We should also be concerned about. But that particular example where you have two people who are both buying a buy-to-let, but one has had an existing main residence and is replacing that, seems inequitable that they would be paying the additional charge, whereas the other who's buying their first main residence would be caught within the charge.
Okay, and you've said that in terms of exemptions, you agree with the policy of providing an exemption for from the additional 3% for investors who will contribute to the growth of housing stock, and you feel that an acquisition by an investor of six or more residential properties should be catered for, but in terms of a portfolio, you're saying an acquisition by any investor of one or more residential properties with that investor will own at least 15 properties following a transaction. Should be followed, is that right?
Yes, I mean, the concern behind this, and it goes back to the point made by Rick earlier on, is that the rules shouldn't prejudice the private rental sector more generally. And so whilst it's difficult for Parliament, I guess, to discriminate, and particularly looking into EU law against different types of investor, what we've looked at is whether there's a possibility of introducing exemptions, and those were a couple of the ideas we'd come up with. So perhaps an investor who's buying more than six in one transaction, that would suggest a more widely held portfolio. So going against the avoidance that the legislation is trying to target, or equally where they already have a number of residential properties and the acquisition takes them above the 15 residential property threshold, similar to that's been suggested down south. And equally, similar to the non-residence capital gains charge, where there's an exclusion for acquirers who are diversely held. So again, moving away from that suggestion where a husband and wife buys and then buys their second through a company to work their way around the rules. Just suggestions, really, as to how that we might be distinguishing, keep the PRS sector going.
Thank you for that. Now, Mr. Gordon, you were going to comment. I was just about to ask you a question on this particular area anyway, but carry on.
It was just in relation to the original question. So although the RICS thinks that there is a need to be careful and consider matching the stamp duty changes because of the risk, that doesn't mean that we think that, or I think, that the LBT overall or LBT as an additional home supplement is a good idea. So LBTD is not progressive, regardless of how you frame it. And the changes were welcome in terms of how LBTD was framed, in terms of the way the thresholds move and the non-slab structure. But overall, it's a tax which doesn't target wealth or income. It targets people who happen to own an asset or have the ability to buy an asset. So sometimes real-life examples are quite good. So my own personal example is I'm 45. I've got virtually no pension. I've got I've got a large mortgage. I've got a relatively modest family home in Portobello. But I would, if I need to move to a bigger home to accommodate my family, then I would pay a much higher price for a similar but larger house in the same area in Portobello. And I really don't have that stamp duty or LBTD money available in order to do that. I have to do that in the next couple of years, let alone get the extra deposit that it would require. So I'm not a wealthy person with a huge income, but somebody who is a wealthy person with a huge income can buy a similar sized house, perhaps in Fife, and pay the same, but buy a bigger house in somewhere like Fife or the Highlands, and they would pay the same tax as me. So in that regard, it isn't a progressive tax. And there are unintended consequences in terms of the affordability element within all sectors in relation to this additional home supplement. So specific examples, again, is a lot of investors, particularly in Edinburgh, we have a number of clients who buy or trade in HMO licensed properties. Sometimes they have emergency lighting and fire escapes or sprinkler systems. They're not particularly suitable for individuals to own and live in as their home. They're suitable for multiple occupancy. They don't even have a lounge sometimes. So an investor buying in that property under the new LBTT structure from last year will pay a fairly high or penal stamp duty rate for a property around about £300,000 or £400,000. But if they were to buy instead three or four properties at a lower value, they would pay no stamp duty on those under the old structure. And under this new structure, they would become even more incentivised to look towards buying smaller properties, which are exactly the type of properties that first-time buyers are trying to buy. So you may well actually have an unintended consequence of pushing people to buy investments in the lower end of the market rather than the upper end of the market.
Okay, that's interesting. I mean, paragraph 17, you've said that more can be done to entice institutional investors to build purpose-built accommodation for rent, not only by providing a stable policy and legislative environment, but creating a financial framework that would encourage them to do so. So I'm just wondering if you can tell us a wee bit more about the kind of financial framework you're thinking about.
So as well as representing the RICS here, I represent the RICS on a number of groups, so the Joint Housing Policy Delivery Group I'm going to be joining next month, but I also am on the PRS Working Party, which supports the PRS Champion. The PRS Champion, for those that don't know, is funded by the Scottish Government and employed by Homes for Scotland, specifically targeted with encouraging that type of investment in build-to-rent homes. And a number of those developments are on areas of land which would not be otherwise developed for homes. They bring in significant amounts of investment from institutional investments, so high-quality potential landlords like Standard Life, Aberdeen Asset Management, those type of companies which have reputations to protect. So those type of landlords entering the market is extremely important. And the PRS Champion is working with the working party that I'm on to deliver a set of recommendations for the Scottish Government. And the Cabinet Secretary is responsible for that, is amenable towards most of the recommendations within that and is already implementing some of them, such as planning recommendations or guidance to councils. And if you look at the Homes for Scotland submission, which includes comment from the PRS Champion within it, then there are very specific reasons and explanations for why an exemption for that type of investment is important, because only a small percentage of the investment in the UK in that sector is coming to Scotland at the moment, and some of that is to do with the risk around the uncertainty over the changes in regulation like the new private tenancy bill. There is a feeling that perhaps some of it, it's just about once it's all in place and finalised, then they'll make their decision and it might be positive. But introducing a tax change at this stage to disincentivise them investing will produce further uncertainty and recalculations that may not then produce investments. And the government's own strategy on PRS from 2013 has... The Scottish Government, since 2007, has done a lot to improve the safety and security of the sector. So we have a repairing standard where everything is mandatory in terms of electrical and gas safety, fire alarms, whereas throughout the rest of the UK, the majority of it is guidance only. So it's a very good, safe, secure place for tenants to live. But so they're creating the right type of environment to create a better sector. But if nobody's buying new houses to put into the sector, the majority of homes are going to continue to be old, existing stock, which is perhaps in poorer repair than some of the new builds. So one of the key recommendations in my own submission, which is separate to the RSS one, is to exempt all new builds from the additional home supplement.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, I'm going to open out the session to colleagues around the table who are all champing at the bit. First one is Gavin, to be followed by Jean.
Thank you. Right, first question then to Isobel d'Inverno from the Law Society paper. You talked about this grace period of 30 days. Now, in my view, a grace period is far better than no grace period. But do you not think 30 days is a bit tight? My fear there is that puts a huge amount of pressure on the seller, who may then be tempted and vulnerable to lower offers late in the day in order to avoid the tax. Is 30 days fair in your view, or was that just a starting point?
That was just a starting point. Obviously the problem with the best thing would be that any purchase of something which was your main residence didn't attract this supplement. That would be the best position, but it is quite difficult to implement that, because if someone already has a house, you know, are they going to sell it, and so on and so forth. And so we were trying to strike a sort of an approach that wouldn't be too problematic and wouldn't let too many things slip through. But 30 days is quite tight. 3 months would be better. Some period like that would be better. Because so many things can and do go wrong. And people are on quite tight budgets these days. And another 3% is quite a lot to have to play into the equation from the beginning. So I think you're right that 30 days is too tight, and that longer period would be better.
Okay, and you're saying people are finding it financially tight these days. From the experience, your experience as a property lawyer and with your clients and the market as a whole, if there was no change to the bill as is drafted as regards this area, do you think that would have a detrimental market impact? Would people just hold back and only ever purchase once they've already sold? Or is it possible to kind of explain what you think would happen?
It's difficult to say exactly what would happen. I think from the point of view of our members, they would need to make sure people appreciated the danger of this 3% emerging, when everybody thinks when they're going through these transactions that it's all going to work out. And often, for one reason or another, it just doesn't. So you need to really be in the position of being able to fund that if there isn't some sort of grace period. So the 30 days also aligns with the time limit for putting in... it's really just trying to have something that oils the wheels.
That's helpful, thank you. If I can turn to the RICS paper, Mr. Gordon, you talked about when the UK measure was first announced, you saw on social media various tweets saying, you know, people were going to start investing in Scotland or so on. In terms of the marketplaces, as you have seen it since the Scottish announcement was made, whenever that was, 12th or mid-December, Have you seen a spike in activity in terms of buy-to-let properties being purchased between then and now, so that they avoid the April cut-off?
So my company looks after buy-to-let properties. So unfortunately for me and our company, we haven't seen a massive spike in that. However, John Gell, who used to be the chair of my PRS forum in the RICS, runs a letting agency in Inverness, and he has seen a significant spike in people trying to buy to let. We've got some anecdotal evidence. We only sell properties at the moment which have been rented out, and they want to sell them on the market. And so we've got a few properties available on the market and off market, and we've actually seen a little spike in people buying a second home rather than buy to let investors for those. There's actually very little interest from... I would probably say similar interest in terms of investors, but a wee spike in people looking for a second home. But not necessarily holiday lets. Sometimes it's people who live in London and their family is all here, or they've got children, they've got their grandchildren living in Edinburgh, so they need somewhere to live when they come up, that type of thing.
Okay. So just for clarity then, from your company personally then, there's not been a spike in buy-to-let, but there has been an increase in interest in second homes. But from colleagues, or
yes,
you know, some of them, or at least one of them, has said to you in Inverness, they have personally seen a spike.
Yes.
So that's a fair...
Yeah. Fair.
Okay. All right. In terms of what in your submission, you were concerned about discouraging smaller landlords. Can you just expand on that just a tiny bit?
There are a lot of, I can't remember the exact term at the moment, but things that people think about landlords that are not true. So there are only a small number of landlords that are not trying to look after the tenants. There's only a small number of landlords that try and push rents to the extreme. And like any either civil things or criminal things, legislation is there to catch the people at that extreme end. So you do have to have things that cover that. But rents in Scotland are not rising at the rates that people talk about. So what's happening is that there's a large increase every year in the number of people having to rent in the sector, and there is no supply to meet that demand. And for that reason, rents are rising for advertised properties. Of the properties that we've got, if we try to, if we do an annual review of what the rents are and compare them to the market for existing properties where tenants have been there, we've got tenants who've been there for 5 years or more. And when we ask landlords if they want to increase the rent incrementally on the tenants that have been there for a long time, because we know the tenants pay the rent, we know they look after the property at that stage. We did an exercise last year where we emailed 100 landlords who the rent had changed significantly in those areas, and not a single one of them wanted to increase the rent by even the incremental amount that we suggested they should. So there's a big disparity and a lack of data about what actually happens in this market, and it's affecting all the different decisions that policymakers are considering, including this one.
In terms of exemptions, the convener asked you a couple of questions about them, but one of the exemptions you mention is exempt new build if owner-occupiers fail to buy after a period of time. Now, we had a similar suggestion earlier, and the period of time it was 6 months in that suggestion. Do you have a view on the period of time that you think would be appropriate?
No, I don't. That came from within the forum. That wasn't one of my own comments. I think it's just difficult to see how, you know, particularly with this sort of payment, when you're trying to sell your home and you can't sell it, who's going to have, so many people are not going to have either the money to pay the stamp duty in the first place on one house, let alone two houses, or these additional charges. So it's hard enough to find a deposit, whatever level the housing market you're at these days, because of the availability of mortgages. It's very difficult to get a mortgage which has a low deposit, where you actually also pay a decent interest rate. So one of the things about that was asked, I think, by Ms. Urquhart, was about the sort of interest rates that buy-to-let landlords pay. It's fairly comparable, but sometimes buy-to-let landlords, when they're remortgaging another property, they have a bigger deposit, and they therefore can get a better rate for that reason, rather than better rates overall in the market. But just on your James, there's other unintended consequences which I wanted to mention. One of the difficulties with the speed of this change is that every time I read somebody else's submission or think again about what I'm going to talk about, there's more potential issues that pop up. And this is not just a minor adjustment to LBTD. This is really a new tax, which will affect the market in unknown ways. So if we've got a number of our landlords, we set up in 2008, so a number of our landlords, probably a majority of our first 100 landlords that we got in 2008, 2009, were people who were unable to sell their home when they moved in with their partner, or they moved to a family home as they were getting married, or having children, and so they would rent out the other property. So the situation allowed them that they were lucky enough to be able to afford to move, but the negative equity, if they had to sell their property, would wipe out all of their savings. So that's going to continue to be the case, and we still have new landlords coming to us who are unable to sell their own home in an area where the market has not improved again, places like Claremaston or ex-council areas, and they have to rent those properties out so that they can buy a family home in an area where they either need to move to for a bigger home or to work. And they'll have to pay the stamp duty on the higher value property, I think, which is fairly penal.
Okay, that's helpful, thank you. If I can move then to Joe Joyce and the KPMG paper, I suppose the main thrust I took from your paper is that you were concerned, or your clients were concerned, that this is a deterrent, this legislation could be a deterrent to the development of new homes. Now, can you just expand on how it would be a deterrent?
And I think, as I said earlier, a lot of this is anecdotal and what we have been hearing from our clients. But it is the extent to which, I think there's two sides to this. So there's the small and medium businesses where you get individuals buying one or two or three properties off plan. And those that guaranteed income going forward really helps them to secure the financing to go through the development. And then there's the large-scale institutional investors, which actually forward fund big developments. And while there is an exemption proposed for large-scale investors for the SDLT surcharge, we don't have any details around if there's going to be a similar exemption for LBTT. And I think that there's two parts to this. So there is the additional charge, but also if there is no similar exemption north of the border, then again, that will make south of the border a more attractive place to invest. So I think it's kind of vital to the way that this new surcharge is introduced, that there is kind of clarity around any exemption and how it would be applied, to provide certainty for taxpayers, but also to provide certainty for those developers who really look for that forward funding.
All right. On the issue of the accidental second homeowner, so those who just aren't able to sell the main residence after they've bought, you talk about an upfront relief for that. Can you just expand on the KPMG thinking on this issue? How do you think we could tackle it?
Well, I think there's a couple of ways to tackle it, and I think Isobel and Susannah's paper also both cover this as well, in terms of rather than having this end of the day approach to when the 3% rule applies, having a main purpose test. So am I buying this next residential property to live in as my main residence? And if so, then we get a relief for that 3% surcharge, irrespective of whether we've been able to sell our previous residence. And then if we, within 18 months, I think we would say an 18-month or a three-year period. We think 18 months is probably all right the way the market is at the moment. But obviously the property market's quite cyclical. So it might be the need to expand that period to 3 years. Then any relief claim could then be clawed back. And given that you're claiming relief, all the information would be on an LBTT return. So Revenue Scotland would very easily be able to pick up whether you'd made that amendment that you needed or whether you needed to pay that additional 3%.
Would we need some kind of guidance or regulations in there? Because, you know, I mean, while I think we do need something like that, otherwise I'm worried about the state of the market. If people wanted to get around it, they could put their house on the market at an unreasonable level. I could just refuse to accept any offers on the property because I don't like the look of the person. There are presumably we'd need some regulations in there to make it absolutely watertight as well. I mean, I think
that's fair. But also I think, as Isobel says, you do have the Scottish GAR. So if you're doing something purely for the purposes of avoiding tax, you're going to be caught. It's quite a strict and a strong measure there. And I think in the majority of instances, people do need to sell their previous home in order to move forward. And if people are buying second homes, then it is quite obvious that it's not their main residence. I do get that there are grey areas there, and I think that is something that is very hard to legislate without reams and reams and pages and pages. It definitely isn't what you want, and that's where guidance would be very helpful. But we do have precedent for this in other taxes, so principal private residence relief for CGT and things like that we could draw on that.
And if I lastly turn to the PwC paper, to Susannah's paper, you've been asked about the investors contributing to growth already, so I'll skip that one. You mentioned if we just stick to this accidental second home issue, I mean, you gave us quite a specific proposal, I think, in your paper about how PwC thinks it could be tackled. For the record, could you just expand on that?
Yes, we going back to the sort of time period, I know we've suggested 3 years, and going back to Isobel's and Joe's suggestion, our preference is that, in fact, any acquisition of an only or main residence would be excluded from the tax. So whilst I accept that that will allow for an incidence of people buying a main residence, living in it, doing up, selling on and doing that multiple times, I think our view and the view of our clients is that the practical inconvenience of doing that means that it's going to be relatively few and far between. You have the backup of the GAR for sort of intentional avoidance. Our suggestion around if we did need to go with a pay the tax and an 18-month period is that rather than having to lodge the tax, there was an ability to claim to submit a request for a deferral application, which could be then revisited within 3 years, which in our view means that there has to be a positive application to Revenue Scotland, so Revenue Scotland could then monitor it and would be able to pick up if there wasn't a sort of further return within the three-year period, or 18 months.
That's helpful, thank you. And last question for you. You seem to have submitted a fairly comprehensive submission to the SDLT consultation, which you submitted alongside your submission to us. I mean, is it your view that we as a committee or the Scottish Government as a whole ought to be liaising pretty closely with that consultation to try and make sure that there aren't unintended consequences on either side of the border.
I mean, the intention, as I understand it, from the release from HMRC and also from Revenue Scotland, is so that the rules, promote first-time buyers. And so the two intentions are aligned there. The timing of the introduction of the tax is very similar. And our clients, as I've said earlier, any inconsistency between the rest of the UK and Scotland increases complexity and uncertainty. So, yes, I think there is. That's a good idea to liaise between the two, framing a similar set of rules. I certainly think that where exemptions are introduced in the rest of the UK, they should also be mirrored north of the border, because we do end up otherwise with a distortion in the markets between the two, and that can never be good.
Well, thank you. Convener, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Jean, to follow by Jackie.
Thank you. Just following on from the point that Gavin Brown raised and your explanation for that, I'm interested in the fact that all of your recommendations are that there should be no difference, that people should understand the market, they should understand the tax, and that it should be clear, and there is no difference. But there is a difference. You know, there's a huge difference between these markets. We heard from our earlier evidence that we attract far less inward investment. Whether you think that's a good thing or not, that's not the case. The point is, it's different. It is a different market. House prices have been dramatically different over the years. And we don't step into this situation right now. So why should it mean, and it may well be that in time there will be differences. Of course there will be. Why are you not recognising of any of the circumstances when you're so determined that the rest of the UK and Scotland should maintain similarity with this tax?
I think in our view and the view of our clients, the paramount point here is simplicity. So most of our clients will trade both north and south of the border, and those can include SMEs as well as large, diversely held property investors. So there may well be differences north and south of the border. We haven't carried out any research to understand that, and that's not what I'm here to advise of. I do think, interestingly, that the difference in the threshold for LBTT up here and for SDLT in the rest of the UK, with 145,000 up here, does mean that the 3% will impose a larger burden, arguably, in Scotland than it would in the rest of the UK, because the rates hike in terms of lower thresholds as you work up through the bands. So actually the 3% becomes a much heavier burden north of the border. So that's something that Parliament may want to take into account when taking a decision on this.
Okay. Joe, do you have anything that you want to add to that?
Yeah, I think, again, there is the big issue of simplicity for our clients. And obviously, given that LBTT is a very complex tax, as is SDLT, and this is, is set out in the RICS paper, this is another incredibly complex add-on to that tax. It's effectively another tax, and we've got both. It is incredibly difficult for taxpayers to manage all these changes. So that's one part of it. The other part of it is that the policy objectives of both governments do seem closely aligned on this. And I appreciate that there are very different markets, but even in the rest of the UK, we've got incredibly different markets. So London and the South East bear no resemblance to the North West. And we've got very different investor types, we've got very different purchasers. And I think that's why this piece of legislation is so complex, and why both the UK government and the Scottish government need to make sure that any legislation that's introduced is robust and fit for purpose. And whether that does mean there is a divergence in Scotland, because that's the best way of achieving the policy objective, that's fair enough, as long as both governments are thinking that through and the legislation is introduced on a sound basis.
Thank you.
Could I just add, sorry, that there are already some quite significant differences here, because the treatment of mixed purchases in the draft legislation which we have appears to be different from the approach that is going to be taken down south. So if you're buying a residential property with a commercial property, so the shop with the flat above it, the LBTT legislation that we have would apply the 3% to that flat, whereas the SDLT legislation from the consultation, it doesn't appear that that's going to be the case. And the same with purchases of six or more dwellings, which are treated as commercial, or taxed at the commercial rates, it looks as though the SDLT surcharge won't apply to those, whereas the LBTT one will. So I think we're already quite different, and you know, there are the other differences that we have in LBTT. I'm not sure that it would be terribly easy to make the two systems aligned totally. So we need to make sure that there is very clear guidance about LBTT, that so that taxpayers are aware of how things work and the fact that they may be different.
Thank you.
Just a quick addition to that is my background in land economics, rather than the RICS specifically, is just the difficulty of whether to match or not match this policy introduced by the UK government is going to be something that the Scottish Parliament is going to face multiple times. The devolution of a small number of taxes leaves little flexibility for altering what you do with the taxation system here. The larger partner in the group, which is deciding on tax for England and Wales, there are 50 million people there and 5 million people here. Those 50 million people are all potential investors in the market here, and that type of competition here, if people really did start, is far too big a risk to ignore. And the same is going to apply to decisions over income tax and everything else. When you only have a small number of taxes to make decisions on, you may copy those taxes changes in the UK, or you may introduce tax changes here, not because it's a good idea to change income tax or LBTT rates, but because you have no other options in terms of other taxes to alter or introduce.
I'm sure our Deputy First Minister will be listening to your comments about that. I wanted to move on actually to your paper, Jonathan, on rural impact particularly and the exemptions that you're recommending. Number nine, paragraph nine on your paper, you acknowledge that the decline in population, insufficiency of lack of housing in rural areas, but then at number 17, on your proposed exemptions, that you recommend exemptions for, at number 26 rather, exemptions for holiday homes. I mean, currently across the area that I represent, which is rural Highlands and Islands, there are many communities where as many as 40, 50, and in some cases 60% of homes are holiday homes, which brings huge problems in these communities. I think if you were to ask a lot of people in these communities, they would probably say that they would like people to pay a higher tax and have no exemption on holiday homes, because it's currently one of the most significant problems that we have to deal with.
Yeah, so that's why oral evidence is good, I guess, because RICS proposal to exclude purpose-built holiday homes is really talking about things like holiday cabins. There are chalets that are built next to and on holiday parks and things like that. So the purpose of the exemption is specifically purpose-built homes for rent, and the same applies to purpose-built student accommodation where it's not suitable for individuals to own them in their own right. So that if you go to Aviemore or anywhere else there in the Highlands, there are purpose-built villages for holidays, and people then stay there for a couple of weeks and rent them out to other people at those times where they're not there. So those are not suitable homes for people to live in full-time.
I hear what you're saying, but on the other hand, why would we single that? I mean, the tourism industry, which is what you've specifically cited to incentivize people to make investments in tourism and advanced tourism, but why would we single out this particular aspect of tourism for tax relief when no other aspect of tourism would be singled out in such a way?
Just anecdotal evidence for myself. So if I want to go skiing, if it snows a lot this week and I want to go skiing at the weekend and I try and book a chalet, then it would be very difficult to do that. And anyone flying from London to Inverness to try and do that as well will find it difficult to book accommodation and come there as a tourist. So specific purpose-built holiday accommodation is not the same as homes for local residents to live in.
Well, I think we would have to disagree about that statement, but to be continued. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Jacketed for by John.
Thank you very much. I want to kind of look at some of the assumptions that have been made in terms of transactions and yield, if that's possible. The Scottish Government estimate the number of transactions to be 8,500 to 12,500. I'd be keen to get a view, given your experience, as to whether you think that's a reasonable assumption. They then, without any unintended consequences, estimate the yield to be between 45 million and 70 million. But once they apply a behavioural response, that drops to 17 million to 29 million. Again, you know, is that, in your view, given your experience, reasonable assumptions to make? Starting with Susannah.
I'm afraid I can't comment on that because we haven't carried out the research and don't have enough evidence to provide on that.
Okay. Yeah, I think our response would be the same. That's not kind of the area we've come at it from.
I'm afraid we can't comment on that.
I'm striking out.
I will always try.
God loves a try.
So I believe that the income from LBTT since the change to that has not met targets or the budget that was planned, and one of those reasons I think comes from unintended consequences, where they're trying to make property more affordable at the bottom level by exempting a large proportion of the purchases from stamp duty from LBTT altogether. Is that it relates back to the example I gave of myself. If I don't move into a slightly bigger house, my house is not available for the next person to move up the ladder, and nor will the first person at the bottom move up from their one-bedroom flat be able to afford to buy my family home when they start a family, and therefore that home is unavailable to the person at the bottom. So there are less transactions at the top because a lot of the people who live in the high-value properties that are subject to the penal rates at the top end are not there because they're wealthy or because they have high incomes. They're there because they have grown with a rising property market. And they may well have an asset which is worth a lot to them, but if they can't move on to their next one because of the new penal rates, then it does not free up the next properties down the line for eventually the first-time buyers, and that is the lack of supply at the moment, because property prices in Edinburgh are rising extremely fast at the moment, and in other hotspots around Scotland, perhaps not in Aberdeen. And the problem is not shortage of supply of homes, it's a shortage of the right type of homes in the right location at the right price.
Okay. There is an assumption, again, that the yield is going to rise in the next 4 years by 87%. Now, again, given your experience, I know you haven't looked in detail at the maths, but that size of rise, is that a reasonable thing to assume?
Don't know.
No?
It's very difficult to... I mean, I think the yield from LBTT, it's probably appropriate to point out there's a difference between the yield for commercial and from residential, isn't there? So, you know, it's the effect of the residential rates certainly has had an impact. And there was indeed a lot of activity before LBTT was introduced, which therefore brings things out of the equation. There won't be the same sort of timescale necessarily for that to happen in relation to this supplement, one wouldn't have thought. But I think we're at the early days of forecasting tax revenues, aren't we? So
wishful thinking than reality, but we can only wait and see. Can I touch on the likely effects of forestalling? Because I think Mr. Gordon it was asked about this earlier. Is there evidence that you're all seeing of a rush to buy or indeed sell properties? Is it more down to changes to the UK income tax regime that are coming in, or is it actually down to this supplement? So I'm keen to kind of get your view as to the balance of what you think is the causal effect. Simpson?
Yeah. I mean, I think I would agree with Rick's in that we haven't seen a huge evidence of that happening so far. However, it will inevitably happen where there is a date fixed. So I do expect to see some increase in transactional activity before April if it proceeds as planned. And so that should be taken into account in budget forecasts. Not a lot more to add than that.
I think from my perspective, while we don't really deal with the individual transactions, the majority of queries I've been getting, both north and south of the border, have been from people who are clients but are ringing up personally about buying second homes, investing with parents, investing with children. And given the uncertainty around the tax, the advice can only be, if you're going to do it before 1 April, because we don't know how this is all going to work yet.
I think there hasn't been a huge amount of information about the proposed LBTT supplement yet in the public domain. So people have a lot of queries about it. I suspect that in the next couple of weeks it will become more clear to people how it works, and that may well trigger greater activity in people trying to buy things before the date. I mean, the timescale for actually starting from scratch and completing transactions may mean that it's just not possible. But there certainly will be some people trying to do that.
So 80% of our new landlords come from people who are moving out of their home. They're not purchasing a home to rent it out. That's one of the major failings in the discussions around this new tax, is a misunderstanding of how the market creates itself and develops. And those are just normal people, and they often keep it because they haven't got a pension. And that is then going to be their pension. I only have minor anecdotal evidence. I've got a couple of clients who are getting rid of all three properties rather than just one because of the changes to the mortgage tax relief, which is coming in. But the majority of our landlords are completely unaware of the majority of legislation changes, smoke alarms, electrical safety, the new tenancy regime that's going to give security of tenure to tenants. We write blogs, send it to them. People don't click on them. They open the email, but they don't click on the links. They're unaware of it. They rely on us to look after everything for them, and they get on with their daily lives because they're just normal working people. They're not, the majority of them are not wealthy investors.
Okay, that's interesting. Can I just pursue something with Ms. Simpson? The KPMG suggested that because of forestalling, people might end up overextending themselves, you know, in the rush to buy. Your suggestion is that lead-in time should be extended. Surely that increases the chances of forestalling. And if you were to extend the lead-in time, by how much?
In extending the lead-in time, absolutely would increase the chance of forestalling. It does give the Scottish property sector the ability to see how this charge hits and lands south of the border. And again, it will go against that overarching view of ours and our clients that certainty north and south should be promoted whatever happens. I do think, just added to my comments earlier on, that with the upcoming removal of interest relief on mortgage payments, which takes effect and obviously not devolved, so for the whole of the UK as of April 17, that could cause, combined with this additional charge, more forestalling than perhaps it has happened in relation to other tax changes in recent years. So it may be that combination of the two that's worth taking into account.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. John, to be followed by Leslie.
Thanks, Convener. I think before I go on to the main point, I was wanting to ask, just to maybe to follow up on that last point. You've mentioned there's been a number of words come in here like consistency, distortion, simplicity, complexity, all of these kind of things. And it seems to me some of them do actually, they're in tension with each other, because you seem to, you seem to be favouring a consistency across the UK, which I assume is because that's where your clients represent. Whereas if we actually had a simpler system in Scotland, as we've tried to with LBTT, which might advantage, kind of first-time buyers and smaller buy-to-let, that would be less important to you. Is that right, because of your client base?
Not particularly, because our clients
base extends to cover SMEs and smaller buyers and investors in properties as well. So I think you're right in that it's a balance to be struck between that simplicity and actually pushing on and helping the PRS sector in Scotland. And just as the point's been made earlier, there are differences between the two markets. We simply haven't carried out the research to understand that in enough detail.
And I mean, in the longer term, is it not a good thing? And I mean, is that not one of the reasons for devolution, that we should compete, the Scottish tax system should compete with the English tax system?
That's a policy decision for government and not something that I'm here to comment on, unfortunately.
But it's part of life. I mean, KPMG and Ernst & Young apparently compete with each other, I believe.
Apparently they do.
Yes. So you are in favour of competition?
Competition's a good thing.
All right, that's fine. Okay. I mean, the area I kind of wanted to touch on was whether there should be different reliefs for different kinds of purchasers. And in the previous session, we also touched on this. And I mean, I know the convener raised the whole question of 6 and 15. I'm still struggling really to get my head around, well, whether there should be any number, and if so, why these are the appropriate numbers. Because if we're trying to, and again, I think both ourselves and the UK are trying to, you know, kind of help first-time buyers in their competition against the conglomerates or whatever, then surely it is a good thing that anybody with more than one property should be paying a bit extra, and that will inevitably shift the balance towards the first-time buyer. Well, I'll start with that just now anyway. So could anyone expand on this 6 or 15 or why they should be favoured?
The whole issue of 6 and 15 is a bit of a strange one. There's no rationale for why the UK government have plucked this number of 15 from the air, whereas with 6, the 6 or more rule brings the transaction within the non-residential rates, and it is recognised that that is a commercial transaction. And it was my understanding that this was something that was lobbied for in the early days of SDLT by the British Property Federation, that it's, you know, it's got sound reasoning behind it, and that's why it was introduced, the same rule was introduced for LBTT. So there is that clear acceptance that a purchase of 6 or more isn't a residential purchase, it's a commercial transaction. So I think that's the first part of that. And then I think the second part is to why they should have relief at all, these big conglomerates as compared to individuals. And I think we probably need more data around this, but I think these larger investors aren't competing with first-time buyers. I think they're buying and investing in very different things. So the larger investors will potentially be buying numerous flats in a big apartment complex to rent out, whereas first-time buyers might be looking to buy existing property stock. So I think there's a key difference there. And I think, again, from what you said before, there's this real problem of second homes and holiday homes, and that isn't something that these investors are... This isn't the area that they're looking to invest in. They're essentially... It's this new build, these purpose-built rental sectors.
Well, maybe I'll switch to Mr. Gordon when we're on the question of new build. I think you suggested that we should favour new builds against older properties. Was that correct?
Yep. So the Scottish Government's own strategy in 2013, A Place to Call Home, A Place to Say, A Place to Call Home, I think, talked about fairness, security and safety, but also encouraging more investment into the sector. In the 80s and 90s, we're probably all aware of a house builder starting to develop a site and selling out all of the properties before they've even been built or started building them. And then when they come on the market, people would flip them and sell them, perhaps at a profit, because the market was moving so fast. At the moment, if you look at a development, there's one next to us in a very popular area for rentals in Edinburgh, in Broughton, next to our office. And there's 300 flats being built by Barratt. They've been built over the last 5 years. It's 300 or so flats. And they build them gradually as they get the confidence to build another block in, because of the number of sales coming through the door. So there is no competition in that development between first-time buyers and investors buying a single flat to purchase. The house builders all have to have a certain amount of land banking in order to plan for the next few years ahead and run their company. Whether that's the right amount of land that they control or not, is skewed a bit because the confidence to be able to build on that site is very difficult, and they can't build any cheaper, and they can't reduce the price that they paid for the land, so they can't sell the houses lower than a certain level in order to make it profitable. So the confidence to build those houses, along with faster build out, because there would be an increase in sales if investors are all pushed towards the new build market, would both encourage new builds to be completed quicker, bringing more houses onto the market, more confidence to start new sites, which house builders are keen to do, which may already be in planning or past planning. And it will also improve the supply in the private rented sector and drive up the quality in the private rented sector by introducing new build properties into the market in the right areas rather than existing properties which are in poor areas with electric heating or old single glazing.
Yeah, I mean, I think I would question the quality. I mean, I've just been visiting some new properties in my constituency, which happened to be built by Persimmon, and the quality is just awful. And so, I mean, an individual investor would be better, either individually or a company, buying existing stock, like my 1950s flat, where the walls don't move. And so, I mean, would we not be distorting the market away from existing properties if we did something like that, if we favour the new property?
So the key difficulty in the private rented sector at the moment is the lack of supply of housing to meet the demand. We often don't take on properties which may well meet the repairing standard because they're just not in a good enough condition. They need new carpets, really. And if a landlord says to me, why are you suggesting you'll only take my property on if we replace the kitchen and put in new carpets, that's £5,000, will I get that money back in a higher rent? I say no, probably not, because there is a shortage of supply and tenants have to take what they can get. So if they rent their property at £500 a month, they will get that, regardless of whether they put a new kitchen in. And although you have specific experience of a development in your area, I have a large experience of visiting flats that I would not want to live in myself. Okay, in the existing stock, and it's much more common to be in the existing stock than new stock.
Okay, and another specialist area that's been suggested is students, that the student purpose-built, I think, was it student purpose-built accommodation, is that what you call it? Purpose-built student accommodation, should be treated differently. Is that generally the feeling? I mean, presumably a lot of students rent anyway, so in a block, and that's always going to be for students, so that's not them we're thinking about. We're thinking about where people buy student flats, kind of out with the main campus setting, I guess.
One of the points about the student accommodation is that a lot of the purpose-built stuff now is cluster flats. So you have a central dining room and kitchen and five bedrooms clustering around it. And in the context of looking at a relief for bulk purchases, the point, I think, is that that's treated as one dwelling for multiple dwellings relief, for example, but actually it's five bed spaces, so maybe it ought to be treated as five. So I think that's one of the points that's being made about student accommodation. Another one is that...
Who's buying that kind of place? Because presumably it's not
investors.
The individual investors. It's not the students, yeah, or their families, really.
Not generally, no.
No. No. But the whole block's not owned by one investor, it's still bought individually.
No, it is.
The whole block is bought?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. So this is looking at it as from the sort of relief for investors type of angle.
It's a different planning class.
Right, okay. So it's not actually possible to buy and sell these individually. They've got to be bought and sold as a block.
No, they haven't got to be.
In theory, they could be split up in future, but the that's not the intention of any investment companies to do that.
Okay, I hadn't quite understood that. That's great.
Although it can happen. Yeah. It can happen in some cases. And there's a sort of vague development of a... when people graduate, you know, they might actually quite like to live in something like that, which I certainly wouldn't, but... well, I don't know, maybe it would be more fun. They are designed really for students to live in. So I guess it's looking at making sure that there isn't a slowdown in the development of these. And the PRS is again something that probably does need a relief, partly because if there is a relief from SDLT, and it sounds as though there will be, it would be unfortunate if there wasn't a relief up here as well, although it wouldn't necessarily need to be exactly the same.
Yeah, you seemed more relaxed earlier on about differences between Scotland and England, because there's so many already. So are we being too slavish in following?
Well, I think the 15 was plucked from the air, so as Joe has said, or so we understand, there isn't necessarily any science behind it. But the scale of investment and so on here is quite different, both in terms of student accommodation and the PRS and so on, so different considerations.
Mr. Gordon?
Just on the investment PRS, I think it's important to understand who these people are that are investing. So Standard Life, Aberdeen Asset Management, the type of companies that invest in multifamily homes in America or building blocks of flats to rent in Germany or Holland or across Europe, where more people potentially live in private rented accommodation than here, and it's potentially more affordable and higher quality accommodation here than you'll get here in the private rented sector. And the two key things stopping that investment in this country over the last 25 years compared to other countries is that there's a lack of land available for them to get, and building houses that has over the years been profitable with the growth in house prices. So it's very difficult for these. They're not wealthy conglomerates of people who are making vast profits. The margins that I see on specific developments planned for Edinburgh and Aberdeen and Glasgow are right on the cusp of whether they can afford to develop the house and make a yield which is anywhere near competing with the commercial investments that they make. And these companies are either investing in building another Gyle shopping centre, or they're building 300 flats for people to live in. And if there's a desire to improve the quality of accommodation for people in the private rented sector, it's absolutely essential that these people are not disincentivised from investing either in the UK or in Scotland, because that 3% charge, either at the beginning of a new development being bought by an investor, which is being developed for them to buy, specifically where they've arranged that with the developer, or when it's traded on later, if that charge is applied at 3% on the value of the investment, it will make the difference between the type of gross and net yields that you can achieve to make it profitable or not.
Companies only operating in the UK, or are you suggesting they're operating throughout Europe and even throughout the world?
RBS is trying to create £1 billion of investment in this sector, Legal & General, M&G, lots of UK-based investment companies. The people that are running the pensions for most people are looking to diverge from commercial into residential at this stage when they haven't in the past. So it's probably, I think, 50-50 maybe that there are the type of pension companies looking to invest here where they won't develop but they'll buy it from a developer.
And then, only investing in UK property or in Spain?
Aberdeen Asset Management would invest Europe-wide.
Europe-wide,
I think. But some of the companies that... So in Holland, far more people rent their home than
yes.
do here.
I mean, my point here is, are these companies used to dealing with multiple tax regimes and multiple legal systems? Because if it's the same company that's investing in Spain and Ireland and England and Scotland, then it doesn't matter if they're used to dealing with lots of different systems.
So different tax rates is not an issue. Penal tax rates is an issue. So they haven't invested here because it's not cost-effective at the moment, up till now, and they're now starting
because
to...
Because the tax rates in the UK are much higher than in Holland or Germany.
I think it's more to do with the price of land and the ability to get the land at the right price to build
right,
houses.
So the tax is not a big issue as part of that?
Well, it's essential as part of that, because that's the...
But land, the cost of land's the main one.
As far as, in my experience, it's all in the mix. If you change the, if you increase the tax that they have to pay, then you'll make it even more difficult to invest.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
But I suppose the point is as well, if you're looking at Edinburgh or somewhere down south, and there's a relief down south from this 3%, and there isn't a relief up here, then you stop thinking about up here.
But then we should also be looking, if the companies, my point is, if the companies are also investing in Spain, and I understand a lot of British people individually do invest in Spain, we should also be looking at the Spanish tax rate and seeing how we compare with it. I mean, I just feel we're too fixated in what's happening in England, although that's the main neighbour, and we're not, you know, shouldn't we also be taking into account, if what Mr. Gordon says is right about international competition, then we should be looking at Spain and Ireland and things as well. but we haven't got time to do that. Right, I'll not expect an answer to that. And my final one just was housing associations. Should we be favouring housing associations in any particular way? Or is there
anybody? I think one point to make is that all the normal reliefs, as I understand it, all the normal reliefs from LBTT will also be relevant for this 3% supplement. So if a housing association is a charity, for example, then it wouldn't be paying the 3% supplement because it wouldn't be paying LBTT on a purchase.
I think the example given before was a mid-market rent where it's maybe a subsidiary which might not be a charity. Do you feel they need to be favoured a bit?
It would be helpful, but as has been mentioned, the more reliefs you add on, there'll be nothing left to collect. So, yes.
Good point to finish on. Thank you. Right.
Pleasure to be followed by Mark.
Convener, I think what we're hearing is actually this does seem to be still some other questions to be asked, maybe some other evidence to be gathered. Can I go back to Mr. Gordon? You've mentioned a number of times about a lack of supply in the private rented sector in Scotland. I'm just sort of joining up a couple of points that you've said. So you've mentioned a lack of supply in the private rented sector, and that's pushing up rents. Okay, and you also mentioned that there's a lack of inward investment in this sector in Scotland. Is that correct, Hedrick? Yeah. So I was wondering, I'm just playing devil's advocate here, and Susannah and Joan mentioned about simplicity. So if we didn't, if the decision was taken not to apply this 3%, would that then be an opportunity to expand the private rent sector in Scotland then?
I think the difficulty is the risk of too much inward investment into us, into here from particularly other parts of the UK. So it's.
Could you just open up what is that risk then?
So, when people are making. So inward investment from outside of the UK is still different to inward investment from other parts of the UK. It's much easier for somebody who's sitting in London or Manchester to consider buying a flat in Aberdeen or Edinburgh. And somebody in China or the Far East is not going to be looking at what tax changes are made here to try and encourage investment somewhere. Somebody might see an opportunity to try and market things to them if that happens, and we didn't have that rate here, then that may attract more inward investment here. But I think, then again, that's a risk. So,
but a risk to who?
A risk to the people that the policy is intended to help. So, people who are first-time buyers, or anybody trying to buy a home that they can afford. So, if more people are trying to buy in the market, then the price rises.
But if there was, because you've mentioned also about if there was an exemption for purpose-built rented accommodation. Where would the risk be there of not applying the 3% then?
So I don't think there is any risk in not applying the 3%. So if the UK government chose not to exempt purpose-built private rented sector build-for-rent developments at scale, then I would think it would be a fantastic opportunity for the Scottish government to attract inward investment and meet the Scottish government's aim, which it has set the PRS champion in Scotland, which they are funding.
Okay.
But they're two separate things in terms of individual new build properties. I would favour an idea where another opportunity is to differentiate by focusing on new builds altogether. And there's less. The groups that I'm a member of committees on, so SPF, Scottish Property Federation, the RICS, the PRS Working Party, there's a consensus across that and many other people about the requirement to exempt purpose-built accommodation at scale. There are a much smaller number of people like me who are thinking that the idea of exempting new builds to encourage more new builds to be built and better quality PRS to enter the sector from new suppliers or new landlords at the individual level would reduce the risk of. Well, it would remove the penalising of small landlords versus these large-scale investors, which I think are needed. But why should small landlords then be excluded from being able to invest if that would then mean an increase in homes? But that would be something where I think a very strong tracking of the data relating to what happens with prices of new house builds, because you could argue that if everything's pushed into that, then the house builders' prices would rise in key hotspots areas. But that's something that at the moment there is no competition in that market, because they're building as they're sold. So they will build more and sell more quickly. But that may affect prices, which would have to be tracked. But that's something that could be a safe exemption to have an interim thing for a year.
Okay.
In my view.
Thanks. On point number 7 on your submission, you going back to assuming that we do apply the 3%, you've mentioned if a supplement is enacted, we would urge the Scottish Government to consider ring-fencing the revenue generated from the 3% for investment in housing.
Sorry, which number was that?
Number 7.
Number 7. So, apologies, because I did my own submission.
All as right. Well as
look at the RICS one. So, the ring fencing, I just think it's important that any taxes that are raised from the property sector are ring fenced and spent in that area, particularly if it's an additional tax. And this is clearly intended to be an additional tax. And how that's targeted could be targeted at affordable homes in particular.
Okay. Thank you. The last question is just a general one. I don't know who wants to answer this one. It's just the fact that it's just about the workability of if it's a second or more homes. In part 6 of the bill, it says what counts as a dwelling owned by a person. And 9.2 is the dwellings situated outside Scotland as well as Scotland are being counted. And I just wondered what your thoughts on actually, if this is implemented, how easy will that be to sort of be, how workable is it?
I think we have some concerns about that. There will need to be quite good guidance. The point being that the legislation talks about ownership of dwellings, and it talks about properties overseas being counted if what you have is similar to ownership of a dwelling in Scotland. Now, obviously, Scottish solicitors are not familiar with the real estate systems in other countries. So how is somebody in Scotland going to necessarily be able to tell whether whatever you've got in Spain, whether you've got something that is similar to ownership in Scotland? So I think there will be quite difficult cases there. And it'll be important to have guidance from Revenue Scotland saying, we think this kind of thing in Spain counts, that kind of thing doesn't, and a list of the things that are in or out. It won't be fair to leave it to taxpayers or their agents to try and fathom whether the thing in Spain, your interest in it, is the same as ownership of a dwelling in Scotland. I think it's probably inevitable, though, that you have to look at properties all over the place. If you're going to look at properties in the rest of the UK, which it would seem sensible to do if this is being introduced. So we do see some issues with this.
Okay, thanks.
I think essentially it comes down to an enforceability, and you will be relying ultimately on taxpayers to self-assess, as with many of the other taxes that are currently in place. And there are exchange agreements between countries, but you're relying on that working. So it's whether it's discoverable that a second home has been missed in another territory. So I do think it's something to be taken into account.
And I think that's why we'd favour a main residence purpose test, because then it wouldn't really matter what you owned around the rest of the world. If you were buying a house with the intention that it's your main residence in Scotland, then you wouldn't pay the 3% charge. If you're buying a holiday home or a buy-to-let, you'll pay the 3% supplement irrespective of what else you own globally. I think that would make things clearer for inward investment. But also, it's much easier to administer, because as Isobel said, you know, legalities all over the world, it is going to be very difficult for people to determine.
I was going to say a comment for once, but just on that part, our general view about the risk of investment from the rest of the UK coming in if we don't have this, I suppose that main residence thing would potentially remove that risk of you know, people looking for a flat to buy to rent in Edinburgh, because it's cheaper here to do that. Because if they have to come and live in it, that's something they're not going to do. So that is a potential change that could remove some of that risk.
I think think, as others have said, the main residence exemption would really be the best way to do this if it could be made to work. I don't know whether... I mean, it's worth mentioning that the capital gains tax main residence comes at the other end. It's a sale-based test, so you can look back and see what actually happened, whereas this is looking forward and what's the intention. But it would certainly be much better. I don't know whether it could be linked with incredibly high penalties if you said it was your main residence and you were basically telling an untruth. But it's always a problem with intention. So you need a period of time after which, if it turned out not to be your intention, and people's intentions do change, and life happens and different things come into play. But it would be a much simpler way of introducing this to have a main residence exemption rather than going through all these hoops of 18 months and one way and the other and holiday homes and all the rest of it. It would be much simpler.
I think just the other point to tie into that is getting the residence definition aligned with both the capital gains tax, principal private residence exemption, and indeed the Scottish resident income tax, because there's another, it's back to my point on complexity and ensuring certainty across the taxes. We having one test for one test for another is just going to confuse matters.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mark?
Yeah, just a couple of questions. Following on from that point about the main residence exemption, I'm interested in that point because how easy to administer or to get around, I suppose, would such an exemption be? Particularly if, for example, somebody purchases the property, says, this is my main residence, and then, for whatever reason, say employment reasons or anything like that, it ceases to become their main residence, or they could argue it ceased to become their main residence. How easy an exemption would that be for somebody if they so choose to do so, to use untruthfully, as Isobel d'Inverno has suggested?
You can actually only live in one place, really, when you get down to it. Mm-hmm. The Scottish taxpayer test, if you have two houses, how do you decide which is the main one? And the revenue of issued lists of sort of things that might be taken into account, like where your family lives, where your credit card bills go to, where your clubs are that you belong to. Anecdotally, it's also where your dog lives is a good indicator. So all of these things, it is possible to determine that the as a matter of fact, I guess it's the intention that's slightly more difficult at the time, but it would really be a question of when you're buying this property, is it going to be the one that you lived in? And if it's not, then you have to go back and amend your return and pay the 3%.
And I guess, would you expect there to be a length of time for which an individual would have to say, this is going to be my main residence for X period of time? Because otherwise it could potentially be that for a six-month period it is their main residence and then they flip it, or could potentially flip it as a means of avoiding the 3% surcharge. I'm it's entirely hypothetical, but at the end of the day, I think it merits some probing if such an exemption was going to be suggested.
I think we've already got clawback provisions in for other reliefs, and they could be introduced here. So if we claim the 3% as a relief, and say, like you say, 6 months later, we move out and get another main residence and claim the relief again. If we haven't disposed of that previous main residence, say, within either the 18-month period or the three-year period, then the relief we claimed on that should be clawed back. We should have to pay that back. And, and we have clawed back in place for group relief, for certain transactions under charities relief, for multiple dwellings relief. So there is already precedent there. I do appreciate that it might be easier for people to be fraudulent, but I don't think this is, fraud is fraud, and people kind of, if they're being criminal, they're being criminal. So, and I don't think the majority of people would be.
I guess that flows into the other question points which I wanted to ask. The first of which is there's been a lot of talk about market distortion and the potential for market distortion either by introducing this 3% or by not introducing this 3%. And I guess the question I have is that the suggestion has been put there that, well, maybe we should have held back for a year and waited to see what impacts there were. Is there a risk that if there were significant displacement as a result of the change being introduced in England and Wales but not introduced in Scotland, it's very difficult to undo that displacement a year later and say, well, we'll put the 3% charge on, but if everybody's kind of rushed to make those purchases in the intervening period, it's very difficult for that genie to get put back in the bottle. It's impossible for that genie to get put back in the bottle, really. I don't know if, Susannah, do you want to kick off on that?
I think you're right that if it was delayed for that period, then obviously there would be a distortion. But for that period, I think ultimately over time, if it was then introduced, things sort themselves out. So it's not necessarily going to harm things for the sort of more distant medium-term future. But there must be a risk of that for the period that it's different.
Don't know if anybody has anything to add.
Yeah, I agree that is definitely a risk. And I think our approach to it was that it's far more risky introducing hastily put together legislation with collateral damage and unintended consequences, which then takes years to unpick, rather than putting together something that is fit for purpose and does what you want it to do.
So I think there are quite a lot of points which we haven't bored you with in relation to partnerships and trusts and joint ownership and so on. There are a lot of technical questions that where, you know, it may be necessary to make improvements to the legislation so that things work as intended.
We do have the Cabinet Secretary coming up next, so, I mean, if there are technical questions that you think should be put, then getting them on the record at least allows for that discussion to be had. You suggest it might bore us for that. I don't know, can't speak for everybody, but if there are specific questions that do need to be put, then I think the committee should be advised as to them. So
I think in relation to trusts, we need to be sure quite how trusts are going to be treated, where there is a corporate trustee, for example. Is that going to be treated as a if a trust which has a corporate trustee buys a house, is that automatically going to be treated as a subject to the 3%, even though the trust doesn't have any other residential properties? And that would be a trust where it's a discretionary trust, so there's nobody with a life interest and so on. Similarly, is it clear that where the trustees are individuals, their purchases in their capacity as trustee, those you wouldn't have thought that those should be affected by what the trustees personally own. So the house that the trustee owns for himself as an individual shouldn't affect purchases by the trustee as a trustee, and also trustees of more than one trust. Do all of these things? Well, what's the intention for them, and do they all work?
Are you suggesting will the purchase be assessed by the trust as an entity rather than the interests of individual trustees, basically?
Well, trustees will either be individuals or it can be a corporate trustee. So, you have to try and think how it ought to work. Well, one thing which you wouldn't think ought to be the case is that if the trustees are individuals buying as trustees, the fact that one of those trustees personally owned a house shouldn't affect whether the trust buying a house has to pay the 3%. So it's those sorts of questions. And on partnerships as well, partners are individuals, so they appear to, it appears to be the case that if any of the partners has a house as an individual and the partnership then buys a residential property, that it would be automatically caught. But that doesn't necessarily seem to be appropriate in some cases, because it might be a farming partnership buying a house for employees to live in. So it's not clear that that sort of follows the policy. So these are the kind of things that perhaps need to be explored a little further.
Okay. I don't have any other questions, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you to colleagues for the questions, and thank you most of all to our witnesses. We've got the Cabinet Secretary. We're going to be starting back at 11:45 sharp, so 15 minutes behind schedule, and we've got the budget bill this afternoon. So we'll just have a brief break until 11:45 to enable an actual break and a change of our witnesses. Thank you. We'll now continue our scrutiny of the Land Buildings and Transaction Tax Amendment Bill at Stage 1 by taking evidence from the Deputy First Minister. Mr Swinney is accompanied today by Robert Buchan, Greig Walker and Sean Neill of the Scottish Government. I'd like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting this afternoon and invite Mr Swinney to make a short opening statement. And I should say, it's not quite afternoon, it just seems like it, because I've been here for so long. It's still the morning, so good morning.
I didn't want to correct you, Convener, but good morning, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity to make an opening statement ahead of this morning's session on the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Amendment Scotland Bill. I would like to start by thanking the committee for the role in expediting the timetable for this bill. The bill delivers against a commitment from the Government in the 2016-17 draft budget to introduce a 3% LBTT supplement payable on additional residential homes, such as buy-to-let or second homes. Subject to parliamentary approval from the 1st of April 2016, anyone buying a residential property in Scotland who already owns one, here or anywhere in the world, will pay an additional 3% LBTT on the whole purchase price of that property, unless they are simply replacing their existing main residence. The bill is being introduced to maximise the opportunities for first-time buyers to enter the Scottish property market and to counteract the potentially distortive effect of the new stamp duty land tax higher rates being brought in the rest of the United Kingdom. Without an LBTT supplement, the SDLT higher rates would have made it relatively more attractive for investors to buy up homes in Scotland, particularly at the lower end of the market, increasing the competition for first-time buyers. The LBTT supplement will be payable on the whole of the purchase price of an additional home for any transactions of £40,000 and above. The supplement imposes greater tax burdens on purchases of additional property, particularly at lower value transactions, where demand for properties for investment purposes or holiday homes can make it difficult for new entrants to the market to purchase a main residence. For example, someone buying a property as their main residence for £100,000 will not pay LBTT, but someone buying the same property for an investment or as a second home will pay £3,000. As noted in the draft budget, the supplement is estimated to raise between £17 million and £29 million in 2016-17 after taking account of behavioural effects, including the impact of underlying LBTT revenues. The Scottish Fiscal Commission has endorsed the estimate as reasonable, recognising the uncertainties posed by the lack of Scottish data on these types of transactions.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that opening statement, Cabinet Secretary. The draft budget states, and you've touched on, that it targets the lower end of the market where demand for properties for investment purposes or second homes can make it difficult for new entrants to the market to purchase a main residence. Now, just one of the things that's been given to us in terms of evidence is that, as the Scottish Property Federation pointed out, is that, you know, the kind of investment which you have said in your opening statement could potentially have a potentially distortive effect is actually only 2% of all investment in the UK comes to Scotland. And so what the Institute of Chartered Accountants in England and Wales have said is that that in copying UK proposals, the Scottish Government has missed an opportunity to distinguish Scotland as an attractive location to live, work and do business. Further adding that the findings of a survey by YouGov for the Council of Mortgage Lenders that 34% of landlords will reduce investment in the private rented sector following the announced income tax changes in the SDLT additional rate. So do you not have concerns in actual fact that we have, as has been said, missed a trick there? Because it's not as if we actually get much in terms of investment in this sector anyway, so therefore perhaps Scotland needs a bit more investment in this sector.
There will always be conflicting ambitions and aspirations in the marketplace, and I think one of the issues which I'm certainly is very much in my mind, and it was in my mind when I designed the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax legislation in the first place, was the importance of ensuring that I created the right investment opportunities for individuals to get on the property ladder, principally as first-time buyers. And I think the evidence of stimulation of that market has been clear to see from the performance of Land and Buildings Transaction Tax since the start of the current financial year. The danger, Convener, in taking up the market opportunity that your witnesses have suggested is that, yes, it could have attracted investment into Scotland, but it could have attracted investment that crowded out the opportunities for first-time buyers to gain access to the property market within Scotland. And simply by the ability of wider and more financially strong individuals or institutions to be able to invest in the Scottish market in a fashion that made it more difficult for new entrants to access the property market. So the judgment I arrived at when I saw the emergence of the proposition in the United Kingdom was that there was a potential for the policy approach that I had taken in land and buildings transaction tax, and which is consistent with the wider policy agenda of the government on home ownership, where we've taken some significant steps to try to strengthen the ability of individuals to gain access to the property ladder, would have been undermined had I not acted to ensure that those opportunities remained open and available for members of the public in Scotland.
Okay, well, in PricewaterhouseCoopers said, for example, that there is no competition with first-time buyers in terms of these institutional investors, and there's a consensus that it takes that this bill should actually exclude purpose-built new build in order to attract them, but at the same time, that wouldn't have an effect on first-time buyers. And what the Council of Letting Agents and the Scottish Association of Landlords have said is that the less favourable legal framework in Scotland is already a disincentive to investment in housing, and therefore the threshold and rates, if this bill is introduced, shouldn't be the same as the rest of the UK.
There's certainly an argument, Convener, which I'm exploring and which I'm interested in. I remain open to these questions in the light of some of the evidence that the Finance Committee has seen on this question. To the extent to which reliefs should be formulated in relation to the application of this legislation. Certainly on new build reliefs, I'm actively considering that particular question and have taken the opportunity to, and will do so, to reflect on these issues once I see the report of the Finance Committee when it's published in due course. There is undoubtedly an argument to be made in this respect, to which I'll give careful consideration.
Thank you for that. Now, the Law Society of Scotland said that bringing in a bill at such haste, I mean, we only concluded our own call for evidence on Friday, and we've had two panels this morning and yourself already, and we're having to produce a report next week, is not conducive to the formulation of good quality, robust tax legislation. Would it not have been better to wait perhaps a full 6 months or a year from the introduction of this measure in the UK, the rest of the UK, before considering whether it could be applied to Scotland, and that would allow development of the legislation greater, allow more time to create more robust, high-quality legislation, as the Scottish Law Society is suggesting.
First thing I'd say, Kavir, is that I think the challenge for the government, and I suppose the test for the committee and for Parliament, is the extent to which we can create robust legislation at whatever moment we decide to do it, and on whatever timescale we decide to do it. And I can think of some legislation which Parliament has laboured its way through, it's given it its greatest consideration, it's been considered by absolutely everybody, and it's been found to be flawed. So, just the, you know, we can give these things all the time in the world and then find that we've missed something when it comes to being tested. So that's happened to Parliament on a few occasions, having given it an extensive timescale. So that's not an argument for, I'm not now going to try to persuade the committee on all occasions that we should condense the timescales for consideration of legislation. I just think it's an observation on what's happened in certain cases. One of the issues which I've discussed with the committee on previous occasions is the fact that our legislative process as a parliament, which has been carefully constructed over many years and which is takes a long time to consider and to assess all the relevant factors within a bill, may not be able to be applied where we have to take swift decisions on tax and budgetary issues. And we've seen some of those interactions already. We saw them over the introduction of land and buildings transaction tax, where our careful, thoughtful, preparatory timescale was essentially overtaken by the actions of the United Kingdom government, and I had to act accordingly. So the interaction of wider factors with our legislative process is not always that simple. I think the challenge for us, and I've taken a great deal of time over the course of the formulation of the tax responsibilities of the Parliament to make sure that we consult extensively with organisations such as the Law Society of Scotland, but there are many others who give willingly and voluntarily of their time to help us in the process of creating good legislation, and I want to encourage that. We adopt a particular approach to the formulation of tax legislation, which is as thoughtful and comprehensive as we possibly can make it. There will, however, be circumstances where I judge there is a necessity for us to act. And I think in this circumstance, going back to some of the earlier answers I gave you, Convener, I would be concerned that to have left this for a year to be implemented or to be considered, and then if you leave it for a year, you might end up having to leave it for longer as some of these issues take time to resolve. We might have found the market opportunities for first-time buyers in Scotland eroded as a consequence of the differential that existed between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom.
Okay, although there's no hard evidence on that we've seen so far this morning. One thing I would say is, though, that the Association of Local Authority Chief Housing Officers has suggested that it should be an early comprehensive review of the impact of this legislation on the housing market, both nationally and locally. Is that something which the Scottish Government would want to do?
I'd certainly give consideration to that, Kavir, yes.
Okay.
I think given the fact that we are undertaking this legislation in an expedited timescale, I think that's a reasonable request to consider.
Okay, just a couple of further points before opening out to the rest of the committee. Loopholes has been raised this morning by the Scottish Association of Landlords and one or two others, and the Law Society have basically said that any loopholes would be covered by the general anti-avoidance rule. So I'm just wondering if you believe that is the case. And also, the Chartered Institute of Taxation point out that the inclusion of exemptions and reliefs provide more opportunities for tax avoidance. So, in view of that whole issue of exemptions, reliefs, loopholes, I'm wondering, do you think we should have this broadly the same reliefs as would be contained in the UK legislation, seeing as you don't want to have any market distortions, or do you have do you want to take a distinctive approach to that?
There's two points I'd make, Convener, in this respect. The first is that is to reinforce the point made by the Law Society of Scotland that the general anti-avoidance rule, which is contained within the Tax Powers and Revenue Scotland Bill, or Act, I should say, is designed to capture any practices that are essentially artificial. Artificiality is the key test in the general anti-avoidance rule. So the Law Society are correct that there is a catch-all threshold. The second point, though, is that in the design and the drafting of the legislation, we have to do that in a fashion that minimises the scope for the artificiality test to be avoided. And by that I mean we have to try to identify in the legislation the approach and the intent, which means that the artificiality test is able to be applied in as many circumstances as may be possible where loopholes have been trying to be pursued. So the combination of our approach is, yes, a combination of the application of the general anti-avoidance rule, but it is also about trying to get the legislation as effective and as focused as we possibly can do. And then finally, Convener, exemptions and reliefs are an entirely legitimate part of taxation legislation, and there will be circumstances where we wish to design exemptions and reliefs to deal with certain circumstances. But they must also pass the test of not being designed to create loopholes. So we have to go into that process of consideration of what may well be the contents of exemptions and release very much with a mind to avoid any artificial behaviour emerging as a consequence of the drafting and the design of those provisions.
The Institute of Taxation helpfully provided an example of a way in which tax could be avoided with regard to this legislation. They basically said Mr A lives in a flat worth £100,000. He buys a house worth £300,000 to move into, and his elderly mother moves into the vacated flat. The supplement would be £9,000. Mr B lives in a house worth £300,000 and buys a flat worth £100,000 for his mother to live in, and the supplement would only be £3,000. And the point they're making is that someone with greater resources can actually manoeuvre the system to ensure that they do actually pay less, as is laid out. And it's just how the Scottish Government would address such matters. I'm not asking you to specifically comment on that, as I've just given it to you. But, I mean, I'm trying to emphasise the fact that, you know, there are still concerns in terms of how the legislation is at present, and I'm really looking to see how the Scottish Government will look at this, perhaps in stage two, to ensure that some of this is tightened up.
We certainly will. We'll look at these circumstances, and of course, we established as part of our routine preparations for tax legislation the Tax Consultation Forum, which enables us to hear the views in the Devolved Tax Collaborative, which enables us to hear the views of stakeholders as part of this process. And indeed, we have had a very helpful discussion with a whole range of stakeholders covering a variety of different sectors and interests, and that's given us a great deal of food for thought. And we will, of course, continue to look at any scenarios that are put to us. But I think, fundamentally, the legislation is designed around the simple test of any circumstance where somebody is purchasing an additional property, they're liable for the LBTT supplement. And that strikes me as being the correct way to go about this, by identifying the very lowest common denominator of tests that can be applied and then applying it. And of course, the government will look at other given scenarios to determine if that test remains to be robust in fulfilling the purpose of the legislation.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm now going to open out the session. The first colleague to ask questions will be the Deputy Convener, to followed by Jackie.
Thank you, Convener. As the Cabinet Secretary probably knows, one of my privileges is also to be in the Delegated Powers Committee, and Ms Brennan and I are both on it. So I suspect you have seen the report, and I wanted to start with that, if I may, this morning, perhaps before moving on to the more interesting side of things. There was one issue where the procedure, it relates to paragraph 14.2 within the new Schedule 2A, inserted by Section 1.3, the power to amend threshold figure in paragraph 9.3 of Schedule 2A, all of which basically is that the government ministers can vary the 40,000 limit. Now, the argument has been put forward that in other places the 40,000 is an administrative figure for notification, but in this legislation the 40,000 is actually effectively a tax band, in that below it properties are ignored and above it people pay 3%. And that's fair enough, but the committee felt that it shouldn't be the negative procedure that was used there, but it should be either affirmative or probably provisional affirmative, thank you, and because that would be what would normally be used for changing tax bands and tax rates. So I just wonder if the government has been able to consider that.
We've not considered that issue in full yet, but I understand the point that's been made. And of course, the exercise of order-making powers is one that we must consider carefully as part of any legislative process. And I'll reflect on the conclusions of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee to determine if there are any changes that we require to make. Given that we exercise order-making powers with the consent of Parliament as being reasonable to be undertaken in a particular fashion. So we have to take parliamentary consent with us on the theoretical exercise of those powers. So I'll certainly reflect carefully on the point that's been made by the committee.
Okay, well, that's appreciated. And I mean, there's one other point that actually came up at that committee, which is relevant but wasn't in the report because it was more policy. But on the 40,000 level, that is at this, that somebody owning a property below 40,000 is effectively ignored for the purposes of this legislation. Now, obviously, valuations can go up and down, and elsewhere in the legislation, it would all be about the cost that somebody has paid. But the valuation could be affected, for example, by whether a property was tenanted or not, and could move up and below the 40,000 level at different times. Can you give us an indication how that would be treated, or at least that you would look at that point?
Well, we would have to go on the... We would have to go on the basis of the purchase price would have to be above £40,000 to...
For 20 years, say...
I think the, I rest my answer on the issue of the purchase price. I think that's the key test of how that judgment has to be arrived at, given the fact that there is a test which has to be applied for notification of a property for LBTT purposes, the point at which a return has got to be made is at 40,000, and that will be driven by the purchase price. Although I'm just looking at the contents of part six, which relate to the point on market value, so I think there's a my sense is that the intent of the legislation is clear, that we want to capture properties at 40,000, so that has to be the test at which the notification has to be made to Revenue Scotland, and it's at that point that individuals would have to register for any payment of a charge in this respect.
Okay, I'll leave it at that just now. Thanks. I mean, there's been a lot made of the comparison with the UK, and the convener's already asked you about that, and I suppose I personally remain unconvinced that, you know, we are dealing with the same market, because, I mean, if you get somebody in London with a lot of, you know, say £500,000 of spare money, and they're thinking of buying a holiday cottage in Arden or Ullapool or somewhere like that, you know, in a sense, 3% is very little difference to them, and I just wonder if we didn't have the 3%, if they would suddenly all be rushing in and buying, more people buying houses, and even if it went up higher to say 10%, would that be enough to discourage them from buying a house? So, I mean, we did have one witness, not today, but in paper, that suggested actually 10% would have more impact on that kind of thing, on trying to discourage second homes. And I wonder if you have thought of going higher than 3% for second homes.
I haven't. I think the you know, clearly the application of the 3% charge is applied differently to the application of LBTT for which we have previously legislated. And it obviously, comparatively speaking, raises a larger charge on... well, let's say a property worth £100,000 as a main residence or £100,000 as a second home. There'll be, you know, very different charges as a consequence. So I think the differential is there. It remains a significant differential. And I think it's part of the calculation that an individual has to make about whether or not they wish to buy a second home. It won't stop people necessarily doing it, because, you know, people may be in the scenario, the financial circumstances that Mr. Mason says, and they're quite happy to pay the charge. But it is a relevant consideration, and it puts up more of a disincentive to making that purchase than would be the case without it existing. And I think I come back to my point to the convener in the earlier questions, that without this, there are, you know, I think our market, in a market which we are very keen to motivate first-time buyers, would be at a disadvantage without provision of this type being in place.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think that's fair enough, and I totally agree, and I would be very much in favour of trying to help first-time buyers or local buyers as against people coming in from outside with a lot of money with a second home. I think we did get quite a lot of evidence earlier this morning, which was quite persuasive, that that area, where I think there's probably broader agreement that we need to do something, is quite different from the private rented sector investment market, where on the whole we probably do want more investment. We want companies coming in, and in some cases it's been suggested international companies which are looking at England, looking at Spain, looking at Germany, and we want them to come and invest. And I just wonder, do we need to treat them differently, the kind of individual second home buyer from the slightly larger investor who will actually create jobs and new buildings in Scotland?
I think we've got to look carefully at the issues that have been raised in the evidence about the private rented market on a larger scale. And I think we've, you know, because that is a more substantial investment in the provision of a wider housing supply contribution within the marketplace, as opposed to simply the acquisition of additional properties which may be taking place in already congested housing markets. So I think there's a I think there are a different set of circumstances that that may well exist there, and that's one of the issues that I'm considering as part of the legislation, and which I'll obviously be interested in the feedback the committee has heard on this question, because there are different characteristics to the market between the objectives of boosting housing supply versus the protecting the market opportunities of individuals to be able to gain access to the property market.
Well, I absolutely totally agree with that answer, so I'm encouraged for that. And just linked to that, one other point that came up this morning was that landlords with either over 6 or over 15 properties should be treated differently, because I think the argument was they were serious commercial organisations, whereas somebody with just 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 presumably wasn't. And yet we were also told that the 15, which I think comes from down south, was a pretty arbitrary figure. I just wonder if you have any thoughts on these particular numbers.
I think there's I think there's a debate to be had around these numbers. Where and I don't think it's a matter of perfect science. I think wherever you set that number, I think it will be a number that will be set on an arbitrary basis, whatever the number is. Ultimately, you have to make a judgment about at what point do you think there is a commercial proposition that is investing in the private rented housing supply sector, or at which point do you think there is just a mechanism being designed to avoid the impact of this legislation? And that's where I think the point the convener made at the outset is important, that we identify what is the purpose of this legislation, and how can we construct the legislation in as robust a fashion as possible to avoid such circumstances prevailing.
That's great. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. Jackie, followed by Gavin.
Thank you very much. Can I explore one exemption or a possible exemption with you that was raised by a constituent? This person, you know, lives in my constituency, but actually for reasons of employment has to live during the week up in Aberdeen. It's clearly not a buy-to-let property. Although it's a second home, it's not a holiday property. It is entirely related to that person's employment, and I wonder whether there's any consideration given to exemptions in those circumstances.
I think the first thing I would say is that the nature of this type of legislation is that there will be a multiplicity of scenarios that can be put to us. I think my general response to the point that Jackie Bailey, which I understand the circumstances that that have been raised, is that I am open to designing reliefs that can meet genuine circumstances that are legitimate within the process. But we have to be very careful that as we go into that territory, there is a fine line between that intent and creating the loopholes of which the convener questioned me earlier on. So I acknowledge the circumstances, and certainly in the light of it being raised with me, I will look carefully at that, as I will to all the arguments put forward by the committee in its evidence gathering process.
Okay, thank you. One of the witnesses we heard from earlier in a written submission today actually questioned the purpose of this legislation, whether it was to raise revenue or whether it was principally to protect housing supply for first-time buyers. So clarity on that point would be helpful.
The purpose of the legislation is to protect the market for access for first-time buyers, but I cannot deny that there is a financial implication and benefit arising.
Well, I'm going to come on and explore yield with you, because I would be interested to know, because I accept the limitations in data, what steps are being taken to improve data collection, because that, I think, will be very valuable in forecasting in the future. Forecasting the likely yield in future.
Well, obviously, we'll be monitoring that very carefully during the financial year. We will get actual practice. I think what we've tried to do in the estimations which underpin the financial memorandum is to construct a picture based on available data that we have through Registers of Scotland transactions that give us essentially the best available data we can have on the volume of second home purchases within Scotland on an annual basis, and the applications for the number of buy-to-let mortgages that there are on an annual basis within Scotland. Now, those are two pretty substantial pieces of data to underpin the assessments that we have made. Obviously, you know, we are in territory here, and where, and this applies right across the whole of the land and buildings transaction tax area, and also actually across landfill tax into the bargain, where, because we are now exercising these responsibilities in a Scotland-only scenario, we were actually able to see the pattern of transactions. The quality of our data is improving with every single transaction. So there will undoubtedly be, at an estimation level, I'm confident that the data that we are using is as robust as it can be currently available. But obviously, if Parliament is to agree this legislation and these provisions are to come into force, there will then be data that will emerge, which obviously will enhance the quality of information that we have at our disposal.
Committee always likes to request more data, so that's pleasing to hear. It, without any unintended consequences, the estimate of yield was 45 million to 70 million. When you apply a series of assumptions about behavioural responses, that drops to 17 million to 29 million. So there's a more realistic assessment there. But I wonder then, you make an assumption that yield will rise in 4 years by 87%. Now, that's quite optimistic, and I'm wondering what you base that assumption on.
I think it's, the difference is, Jackie Bailey is correct in her numbers, but there is a substantial explanatory factor, which is forestalling in year one. So we're not, the year one to year four comparison is not apples with apples. It's got forestalling in year one, which, of course, if there is a forestalling effect in year one, on this precious occasion, the Scottish Consolidated Fund will be the beneficiary of the forestalling effect, which is always pleasing to the Finance Secretary. But that forestalling effect will only be present in year one. So the comparison, so the growth, the wider growth, if we take that factor into account, the growth in the LBTT supplement follows the same assumptions base as the growth in LBTT in general, and those assumptions have been tested and scrutinised by the Fiscal Commission?
What is interesting from the evidence we've had today, and I'm sure you'll take an opportunity to reflect on that, is anecdotally people weren't seeing evidence of forestalling and noted that there may actually be a limited period, before the 1st of April, in which people could complete these transactions, which I thought was interesting in that it was different to the experience of LBTT. So I don't know whether, you will bring forward a set of revisions on that basis, but the anecdotal evidence was there was no evidence of a rush to buy. There was uncertainty in the market because people weren't aware of the proposals being brought forward.
It's early days. I announced this on the 16th of December, and I suppose that really only will have given people a few weeks to have considered these issues. So that it may be early days. I'm just trying to recall in my mind the timescales around the explanation of the LBTT change, or the interaction of the LBTT changes that I proposed and the SDLT changes that the Chancellor made. And if my memory, I announced the LBTT rates in, I must have done that in October 2014. And then the Chancellor would have announced his SDLT changes in December of 2014. So you had the Chancellor making his announcement that sparked off the forestalling at exactly the same point as I have made my announcements, or around about the same point as I've made my announcements here. And we've clearly seen forestalling in the introduction of vanilla LBTT, if I can call it that. So we may see that, or we may not. What we've done in the assumptions is made an assessment and take an account of forestalling. Now, if it doesn't materialise, well, the Scottish Consolidated Fund on vanilla LBTT will not get the benefit, but we'll see it coming through in LBTT, in the LBTT supplement, if the pattern of property acquisitions takes the form that I estimate it will.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Jackie. Gavin, to be followed by Mark.
Convener, thank you. Cabinet Secretary, I have no inside information here, but just say for the sake of argument, the UK government had heard some of the concerns that we've heard this morning and took the decision, for the sake of argument, to delay implementation of this by 6 months. So I've put a number there at random. Let's say they delayed it by 6 months. What would your response be to that? Would you follow in suit, or would you want to apply it on the 1st of April regardless?
I would apply on the 1st of April.
Regardless of what they do. Okay.
Assuming that Parliament agrees to all of this.
Sure, of course. Okay. But you wouldn't...
not minor assumption, but yes, okay. That would be my plan, yes. Right.
In terms of, obviously this is a delayed, devolved power, and you're perfectly, in Parliament's perfect liberty to ignore what goes on south of the border. But in terms of the practical impact on the marketplace within Scotland, I would caution against ignoring it entirely. Are you having discussions with the UK government on the consequence of their consultation to try and get a feel for what they're doing? And are you giving them some idea of what your thought process is so that we nobody is hugely disadvantaged, or are you kind of not discussing it?
Well, obviously, we're looking very carefully at what the UK government has consulted upon, of course, and we've looked at the consultation document that the UK government has produced, and we've looked at the various issues that they've considered. There are discussions between officials. We're obviously in territory where I think I'm, although I'm at the front of the queue to demand access to information from the UK government, I do accept that we're in a space where it's tax provisions, it's tax regulations. I think it is difficult to have an open book on some of these questions. But we're certainly having those discussions with the UK government and looking at their announcements.
One of the issues that came up this morning, quite a lot, was the idea of somebody who doesn't want to become a second homeowner in any meaningful way. They're selling their property and they want to buy a new property in terms of their main residence in each case. they purchased a new main residence, and for whatever reason, either the sale breaks down or they just don't get a buyer initially. My understanding of the legislation as drafted is they'd have to pay this 3% up front, with the ability to claw it back upon the date of sale of the main residence. Are you open to some form of change to that, so that there doesn't have to be an upfront fee, or are you fixed in your view?
I think on that point, I've weighed up the arguments, because I don't think it's an absolutely a black and white case here. I've weighed up the arguments, and I think the most efficient way to do it is to secure that upfront payment, given that you essentially would have an outstanding liability which you were trying to recover at a later stage, which I think would be a more, which potentially could be more challenging for the public purse to recover. So I think on that basis of tax collection efficiency, I think the argument is balanced in favour of the upfront payment with the rebate opportunity.
Okay. I mean, it's definitely administratively simpler with less risk to the public purse. If you, I mean, presumably you're speaking to a stakeholder group at the moment. I think the policy memorandum, you know, explicitly mentions them. I mean, if you get evidence though in the coming weeks from stakeholders who have concerns about the economic impact of that, would you be open to dialogue?
I don't want to suggest in any way to the committee that my mind is closed on most questions, other than the fact that I'm proposing this legislation and it has its. I'm quite willing to. I appreciate that this has been done in an expedited timescale. I always try my level best to listen carefully to the feedback that I get from stakeholders and from committees, particularly. So I would in no way want to suggest that I'm unwilling to consider points put forward by the committee or by the stakeholder community. And as I say, I've been grateful to the stakeholder community for the input they've made so far.
Okay. No, I'm pleased to hear that. I mean, I'm no expert at all, but just instinctively, I just think a lot of buyers could become more cautious about actually then taking the leap. And if that is reflected in the marketplace as a whole, then we get a bit of a slowdown. The magnitude of which is unclear. But if you're open to stakeholder views, then I can leave that issue there. In terms of, I mean, you're listening closely for reliefs and exemptions, and you haven't ruled them out as such. And in your memorandum, you talk about a couple you're openly are considering. In terms of the financial memorandum, though, your central projection is £23 million. Is that, that's correct? Does that assume there are no reliefs and no exemptions, or have you factored into that £23 million the fact that there may be some exemptions?
The fact is, you know, we start off at a range of £45 to £70 million, and we come down to a range of £17 to £29 million. Now, that's a pretty broad range of factors that we of cost estimates that we're operating within, so the assumption that so that there's lots of scope in there for difference. The proposition that I've put forward is based on the legislation as it stands, so which I think would be the standard expected of me in terms of the financial memorandum. So there are no reliefs included in the headline assumptions that have been made, but I've erred on the side of caution in terms of the scale of factors that I have applied against the baseline proposition. You know, I could have settled on a baseline proposition which would have been somewhere around about £55 million. Well, I'm, you know, well away from that. So the extent of the application of reliefs of course must all be at the margins in any tax provision. You know, when you get into tax provision, when reliefs predominate, then I think, you know, you're maybe not taking the wisest of decisions.
All right, but the figures in the financial memo just reflect the bill as drafted is a fair comment. Okay. The point was put forward by a number of witnesses today that the bill as drafted could deter new development, new building of homes and properties. Do you dismiss that, or do you accept there could be something in that, and therefore you try to amend the bill to minimise any deterrent?
I think it depends on what scale we're talking about. Okay. If we are talking about I suppose more than a handful of new build properties, if you know, if an individual was developing the possibility of a development of more than, let's say, four or five new build properties, I don't think there's a disincentive in this legislation for that to happen. But obviously I want to listen carefully to the feedback from the market to make sure that's the case.
Okay. And just finally, out of interest, do you view this as a new tax or an amendment to an existing tax?
Well, I suppose it depends who's asking the question and what capacity. If it's for a Conservative website to to tot up the new taxes that are being introduced, then I think I would call canny, as they say. This is a supplement to an existing tax arrangement.
Okay, grateful. Thank you.
Come here, thank you. Mark, to be followed by Jean.
Thank you very much, Convener. The evidence that we've taken so far today, one of the suggestions that has been put is that many new build developments rely on advanced sale of properties, and that the buy-to-let market is a key component of that. Although when probed for some numbers that lie behind that, there was a lack of that forthcoming. But the suggestion was put out there, and that this the 3% supplementary charge may act as a deterrent to investment in these areas, and therefore might restrict the ability of companies to finance new build developments. Is that a concern that you've been made aware of? Is it something that you've considered when looking at this?
Obviously, in the evidence that's been put forward, a number of points in that respect are advanced. What we have to do is we have to test those arguments and to come to a conclusion as to whether we consider the evidence to be valid or not. And obviously in all the evidence the committee has taken, as well as in the stakeholder community dialogue that we have undertaken, we will be going through that exercise to test the validity that we consider applies to all of that evidence. Mm.
One of the other suggestions that was made this morning was that what Scotland should be doing is sort of stepping back and waiting to see what happens as a result of the introduction of this surcharge by the Chancellor. But I think it would be fair to say that certainly PricewaterhouseCoopers agreed that there is a risk inherent in that it could lead to significant market distortion in Scotland, which then has already taken place by the time we get round to doing anything. So is that one of the reasons why you think this needs to be introduced simultaneously in order to prevent that potential market distortion from occurring?
Precisely my rationale, and my rationale for the timescale that I think you never come to these judgments just in one neat little compartment. The government looked at this question through our agenda on housing supply. And, one of the clear things that it's very obvious to me from Parliament and from Parliament's views on these questions is the importance of securing opportunities for first-time buyers to gain access to the marketplace. And when that is a priority for Parliament, and it reflects also the government's agenda on housing supply, then I think the necessity of acting swiftly is very clear, because we want to avoid a situation. We've actually gone through a reform on LBTT, which has improved accessibility to the marketplace for first-time buyers. I don't want to see that set back by a change that takes place in the rest of the United Kingdom, which creates an implication within Scotland from which we don't have the opportunity to recover. And that's exactly why I've taken the action I've taken.
And just before you came in, we were taking evidence from Law Society for Scotland, and Isobel d'Inverno put forward an area which she felt merited some probing. It may not be something you have at your fingertips. It may be something you'll need to come back on. It was around the role of trusts. So where a trust which has itself no property portfolio or doesn't own any properties previously, makes a purchase, but that trust has either corporate or individual trustees who have property interests, would those be assessed against the purchase and therefore make them liable for the supplementary charge, or would the trust itself be treated as an entity making its first purchase?
I think off the top of my head, the trust would be judged to be undertaking its first purchase on that scenario, but I'm a bit loath to give definitive responses on scenarios that are put to me at committee. That's how it would strike me as being considered, but it will be one of a number of scenarios that we will look at.
I appreciate that, but obviously it was given to us on the record, so I thought I would put it to you. Lastly, you've spoken in response to the convener around the way in which we approach budgeting in this Parliament, and this is another example, I think, of what I see as an inflexibility of approach compared to that which is afforded at Westminster in terms of the ability to make changes in relation to tax policy. Do you think that the way in which we're approaching this could be improved, or do you think it's a matter for the Finance Committee to consider as part of our legacy paper around how the budget process works with the taxpayers we now have and the potential for more taxpayers coming in future?
I think this is an issue that we need to look at, and I think I certainly would encourage the Finance Committee, which in a sense observes the same issues and challenges that I observe in relation to this process, to reflect on. So obviously I would welcome the committee's thoughts and deliberations, and I'm quite sure that reflection would be considered by ministers after the election in May. I think our experience in arriving at the approach that we've taken to the exercise of taxation powers over the last couple of years has generally worked satisfactorily, but it has thrown up some significant issues and challenges about timescale. And I do think there is a question that needs to be considered here, and the Finance Committee will be best placed to do that.
Thank you. Jean, to be followed by Leslie.
Thank you. Really following on a familiar theme here, I think, Cabinet Secretary. But I wonder, did you consider not introducing this tax?
But I actively considered whether I would introduce it or not. So yes, I suppose I did. Yes, I thought about doing it. Yes.
And in your opening remarks and also in answer to earlier questions, you said that really it is about fearing a disadvantage for first-time buyers as a kind of principle of accepting that this new tax, is it not? Is that's your biggest concern?
My biggest concern was that your Parliament could have quite reasonably turned round to me in the light of the Chancellor's announcement and said, what are you doing to protect first-time buyers and the access that they might have to properties in Scotland in the light of what the Chancellor has done in England? And I think that would be a pretty reasonable question for Parliament to ask me. And whenever I heard the Chancellor's announcement, I began thinking about the implications, because I have to think and about the comparative impact of taxation decisions in other parts of the United Kingdom now that I exercise some of those taxation responsibilities. And as I work my way through the difficult, very difficult issues of the fiscal framework, that consideration becomes ever more clear to me, that we have to be mindful of the implications of decisions that are taken elsewhere on the potential impact on our policy objectives here in Scotland. So having looked at what the Chancellor set out, it became clear to me that the policy objectives that I would wish to pursue about first-time buyers and access to the market are potentially constrained by the decisions that the Chancellor had taken, and therefore I should look at this particular proposition.
It seems to me, and you may not agree, that there are other ways of protecting first-time buyers. Did you look at alternatives to that, if that was the principal reason for accepting the tax?
Well, I have to look at the implications of this definitive proposition as to what it's going to do for the marketplace and the market conditions. And I have to look at what I think will be the most focused and targeted measure to aim to do that. And that's what I've looked at.
Okay. There's been a couple of questions around large developments as opposed to smaller. Do you agree that to have some, that larger developments possibly are eligible for different finance and seen in a different light, rather than comparing with somebody who has one-bedroom flat to rent or making a small flat eligible for an aged parent or whatever? I mean, what would be fairness in that system?
Well, there are very different scenarios that we have to look at as to whether or not any exemptions are going to be, the fairness of this is that as currently written, it applies across the board. So equity is delivered in that respect. When we go into the territory of exemptions and reliefs, we have to be acutely aware of the issues of fairness and equity as we consider those questions. And we also have to be mindful of a whole range of different scenarios. Jackie Bailey has put one scenario to me today. There'll be other scenarios that will have been put to the committee about circumstances of people living in a property and creating an extra property for an elderly parent or a disabled a child or sibling. And we have to work our way through all of those possible scenarios to determine if we consider exemption, and then right the way through to major buy-to-let schemes that might exist. So we have a range of different issues that we have to think about as we go through that process.
But we can take it really from what you're saying that the two basic principles will be protection for first-time buyers or encouragement for first-time buyers or availability for first-time buyers to get on that ladder, and fairness. They would be the two principles that you would consider. I know that you did say that sometimes there's a lot of time allowed for legislation and it's not any better than the one that is rushed through, but I think there has been comments given a year, and I hear what you're saying, but in an ideal world, presumably, you might have given this more time.
I suppose, more time is always nice to have, but I've got a problem that's going to start crystallising on the 1st of April, and I want to be able to act to deal with that and to address that to protect the market for first-time buyers. So I would be leaving myself open to a problem crystallising, which I don't think would be beneficial to the market in Scotland. But I think, I come back to my answer to I think it was the convener on this question, that we have to make sure this is our opportunity to try to test the parameters of the legislation and the preparation that my officials and I have taken to bring this forward, to ensure that we make this legislation as effective as we possibly can do.
Yeah, I think it's also a test of legislation being made in Westminster and how we react to it too, Cabinet Secretary. And I mean, potentially we could have legislation made very, within months of a new tax year that there simply would not be time to introduce. So, we need to be prepared for that kind of scenario in any case, are we not?
Absolutely. And that's why I think the committee needs to look at the issues that Mr. McDonald raises. Mm-hmm.
Very good. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Leslie?
Thanks, Convener. Can I just ask, firstly, you, because I support the principle of obviously protecting first-time buyers, and I think it's always in the detail, isn't it, to make sure that we get the solution right. But today we've heard from the Law Society of Scotland, KPMG, PricewaterhouseCoopers about their concerns, and actually in the written responses to the consultation about people's concerns about unintended consequences and about some just the really small sort of technical details that actually may not till actually if it's put in place may not be sort of brought to light as an issue. So I suppose, and also you have mentioned about the lack of data, but I wondered what, because you had mentioned about it's almost a crowding out of buy to let. If you don't put this in place, the supplement in place, there's almost a crowding out from buy to let, crowding out first time buyers. So could you tell us what evidence you have of that crowding out?
First of all, it's my first opportunity to welcome Leslie Brennan to Parliament. So if I could take that opportunity in the Finance Committee and wish her well in her time in Parliament. To deal with the subject, I think the issue of the holy grail of legislation is how to avoid unintended consequences. This bill is no different to any other bill that Parliament wrestles with. And we've had the benefit of input from a wide range of the stakeholder community. And this is the benefit of having these conversations, that they just throw up scenario after scenario after scenario, which you have to think, well, does the legislation, how does the legislation relate to that scenario? And I don't question any of these scenarios. They are of the type of the ones that Jackie Bailey raises with me. And we've got to think, well, how does the legislation relate to that? How does it capture that? Is that what we really want to do? And so we have to be mindful of that and take it seriously. And that's why we will take seriously, well, we've taken seriously the feedback from the stakeholder community, while we'll take seriously the evidence the Finance Committee has heard. I think on the question of the evidence, I have to make an assessment of what I think the implications would be for the market in Scotland from the existence of the legislation south of the border, and to make an assessment of what I think the consequences of that will be for the marketplace in Scotland. And the conclusion I've come to is that there would be an incentive for people who would incur a charge south of the border to come to Scotland and not incur a charge in the market. And it's most likely to be in the market that first-time buyers are going to be trying to get access to, whether that's in properties that will be at the in a level of the market which currently would attract no LBTT charge below £145,000, and that's going to be the first-time buyer market. And I can't, it's like all these things, I can't definitively prove we're going to have this upsurge of cases, but I can foresee the circumstance emerging that will be the case, and therefore there is a necessity to act to ensure we don't find the market skewed by that factor.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask about the other, about like second homes, and in part 6 of the bill it says about dwellings, not people who own dwellings but actually outside Scotland, and can you just talk us through about how you see it being enforced, and also how do you see that acting or being implemented and actually being enforced in Scotland?
When a transaction is undertaken, the information that will have to be made available to Revenue Scotland will require a declaration to be made as part of the return as to whether the individual owns a property elsewhere. So that will be part of the administrative process of which a solicitor will also have to when a solicitor is undertaking a transaction, if somebody lives outside Scotland and they've got a Scottish solicitor acting for them to purchase a property, the solicitor is going to have to ensure that the information that we require to substantiate a Revenue Scotland return is made available. And one of the points that will require to be confirmed is whether they own a residence elsewhere. And that will obviously, you know, it's part of the, it's why we have solicitors, it's why we have, you know, the professional standards that are required there to make sure these answers are, these questions are answered properly and effectively.
Do you think, because a couple of people who'd, from the witnesses today had suggested a main residence test, do you think that that's needed?
It will, there will be one that will have to be will have to be passed as in terms of the information that will be required in the return to Revenue Scotland. Okay, let me consider that point. I think the point is quite clear that we are, you know, we will require individuals to disclose whether they have a main residence, and that will be the trigger for this supplement. But if there is any further scrutiny we require to do on that point, we will certainly do it.
Just one last point. It goes back to what something that Gavin had mentioned about if you almost become accidentally have a second home because you can't sell the other one, would you consider introducing a sort of grace period? I think we've heard comments of 30 days or 90 days.
I'm quite open to a grace period question. I think it's, you know, we'll then come back to how long should the grace period be. I've heard that evidence, and I certainly wouldn't want to close the door on it at this stage.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'd like to thank all the colleagues who've asked questions today. Cabinet Secretary, have you got anything further you want to
Nothing further to add. Could you other to reinforce my appreciation to the committee for its willingness to consider this on an expedited basis in what I know is a very congested timetable for the committee.
Thank you very much for that. And just before we wind up, I'd like to give my particular thanks to Professor Gavin McEwen for his excellent briefing, which was provided to all members today. It was an excellent piece of work and extremely detailed. So thank you to that, Gavin. Okay, with that, I'll call the meeting to a close. Thank you.